upon the cross he gave. All that I'll ever need. When he rose up from the grave in victory. Yes, every day I see what Christ he did for me. And every day his love for me. For upon the cross he gave all that I'll ever need. When he rose up from the grave in victory. What Christ he did for me, and every day receive his love for me. For upon the cross he gave all that I'll ever need. When he rose up from the grave in victory. Oh, every day I see what Christ he and every day receive his love for me. Well, for upon the cross he gave all that I'll ever need. When he
I'll
justice. Sing of your judgment. Sing of your everlasting covenant. Oh Lord. You shall sing of his justice. Sing of your judgment. Sing of your everlasting covenant. Now sing of the glory, sing of the mercy, sing of the love of the Lord forever.
Sing of the glory, sing of the mercy, sing of the love of the Lord.
I will rejoice in the Lord. I will rejoice.
Here's what everybody's got to learn. This is the thing that God is saying. It's the place of your emotions and your passions that the river explodes in you. The only way that you can come into this realm of glory is with all of your heart. Can't come in with anything less. All the praise deep down inside by the Holy Ghost begins to explode in the depths of your being, and the glory will overwhelm your soul. Come on in. We enter in. We enter in with thankfulness. Don't care what you say. Sacrifice of praise by Jesus Christ, the Ancient of Days. We come with all boldness by the blood of the Lamb into the holiest of all, and we worship you. Bowing down, we worship you. We take off our crowns and worship you. Lord Jesus Christ, we worship you. Devale kize abo tun mai hebra basi ele obo mandero ki evre vedi nan mai a servie pun manola ke pri babalo pina alleluia alleluia. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah, filled my mouth with laughter. He fills my mouth with laughter. Oh, the joy of the Lord. Oh, the joy of the Lord. He fills my mouth with laughter, and the wellspring spring of the river flows. He fills my mouth with laughter. Ooh, oh, the wellspring spring of the river flows. Ah, this glory of heaven by the Holy Ghost. He fills my mouth with laughter. Ha ha. Woo! Ha 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 ha. Oh, he fills my mouth with laughter. It's joy all the time. Oh, the wellspring springs and the river flows. This glorious praise of the Holy Ghost. Ha ha ha. Ha ha ha. Hallelujah. Ha ha ha. Oh, the well springs, springs, and the river flows. Spring up, oh, well within my soul. Oh, the well springs, springs, and the river flows. This great outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Mamane Rayo. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, the well springs, springs, and the river flows continually within my soul. Come on now. Come on now. Take these words and come to the throne room. Take these words and cry to the Lord. The well springs, springs, and the river flows. Oh, this glory of the Holy Ghost. Spring up, oh, well within my soul. Say, spring up, oh, well within my soul. Oh, the well springs, springs, and the river flows. Come on now. Come on now. Come on now. Come on now. My time, my time, my time, my time. The high praises, sharp two-edged sword in your hand, and the high praises of God in your mouth. Oh, lift your hands and worship Him, the one who redeemed your soul from sin. Oh, worship the Lord with the Holy Ghost. Let the river of God flow. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. Somebody said, I don't get loud in the morning. Yeah, you do. Starting now. Hey, my name. Oh, well, spring, spring, and the river flows. This great outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Oh, the well, spring, spring, and the river flows. That the glory of the Lord may be seen in the earth. For the well springs, springs, and the river flows. This glory of God by the Holy Ghost. For the well springs, springs, and the river flows. That the glory of God may be seen in the earth, seen in me, seen in you. Everybody shout to the Lord with the voice of triumph. Come on. Said, well, you know, it's just too early in the morning for me. No, we're going to teach you how not to have too early in the morning, how not let your body rule you. and not let situations dominate you. Hallelujah. Jesus. Say Jesus.
Jesus.
My key.
Sovereign ruler over me.
Holy Spirit,
I yield myself to thee.
Holy Spirit,
I yield myself to thee.
They do not realize that the supply of heaven, all the glory of heaven's on the inside of them. They don't know how to access. They're still waiting for God to do something that he's already done. I'm telling you, when you can break through to the realms of God's glory overwhelming every part of your being, you'll discover the place of divine health. You'll discover the place of divine strength, divine ability. I'm telling you, dear people, one day, you'll step over and you'll see, my goodness, I've had this supply all the time. And I've been willing to just move into it every once in a while instead of living continually in this flow. This is a place where God will touch your body, touch your mind, touch your life, touch everything about your spirit, everything about your soul, everything about your needs. Hallelujah. 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 Mamaya. This is the place of faith. This is the place where faith, this is the place where faith explodes, where faith's released, where faith will grow. Zabayala mongota ya rebekumans. Mandele beki na mandale umamani. Jesus. Mamana na mangara mena na shira la momba dea. Zuzurida na mangeshi kina na mahandolo bohoho si ha ha ha. Mohoho, mahoho, mahoho, si ha 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 ha. Mandaya la mahusita na mahapi elekiya ma ha 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 ha. Zodaya roma mane kesheya ma ha hallelujah. Molo sodara makisha le mahakiya bohoho. Mahaleo basaleya la magada ya roba maye. Mandaya la mahusoto yo ho ho. Ma ha ha ha. Vita yo mama deo mama deo mama deo mama deo Vita yo mama sukaro mangele le beke mama na ise Zepu mama deo mama deo mama so mama deo Ha 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 manandera. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Holy. Mandaya rababa rababa lata. Holy is the Lord Most High. Oh, holy, oh, holy is the Lord Most High. Ha, ha, ha. Come on. Badayolo. Sebrebe. Mandama mande kisi. Mamba malande, hey, woo, Mandea, river of God, pour forth through me. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I want you to listen to me. I want you to understand something. People don't realize how easy it is to receive all that Father has, but what you have to do is be willing to break through all the things that would otherwise rule over you and subdue you. It may be sometimes nothing more than a tired body. Sometimes it's a harassed and tormented mind because of issues, circumstances, fears. Or you may just feel just kind of what you describe as normal. Father don't want no normal. No normal will ever touch heaven. And if I can get you to realize this, if I can get you to realize how the Father has empowered you and I to break past all the things that seem to be by a wonderful realm of intimacy, a place where God is allowed to touch every part of our being. People want to just stand there and be like this and think that God's going to do it. It doesn't work that way. Because if you continue to stand like this, you would be in the presence of God, basically looking at him with your eyeballs and standing like this. There's things that Father wants to move and do in and do things on the inside of us that goes beyond the sensual realm, that which you can see and hear and understand. Ha, 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 mandaya kaya puta ha. You know, I know a bunch of people got hit with a stomach flu and things of that nature. It tried to hit me too. It couldn't reside. You know why? I just started going, Zayabaya Selama. Oh, Manana. Boku said, It's a will, it's a force of your will. And it's not just some religious exercise. It's something that all of a sudden begins to overwhelm every part of your being. I'm so blessed everybody comes to the School of Spirit like on this past Friday night, because I love helping people understand how to let God, the Holy Ghost, touch every part of your being. Yeah, he comes in a sovereign move and knocks everybody off their feet and then says, now walk like this. See, when I discovered that you could have a move of God, a revival, outpouring of the Holy Ghost to be continually filled with the Spirit all the time, I decided that I'm going to live in it all the time. Hallelujah. Woo-hoo. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Look, some of you looking at me strangely. But God's church is like this. It begins, every meeting begins with the baptism in the Holy Ghost and fire, where everybody's knocked off their feet. That's God's church. That's God's church. That's God's church. I don't care what anybody told you. This is what God did, what he said. That's the president's. That's God's church. Many years later, probably 30 years later after Pentecost, 25 to 30 years later, the Apostle Paul says, what will we do then? We're going to have church the same way, basically. Is it okay? This is the free-flowing version. We will pray in the Spirit. We will pray in the Holy Ghost. And we will pray in the understanding, also thanking God that He has given us the divine ability to do the things He's called us to do. We will sing in the Spirit. Somebody asked me one time, they said, why can't I do that? I said, because you've never gotten your emotions and your passions involved with God. You stepped in ankle deep. And I'm going to tell you right now, for many people in the church today, it's not even ankle deep. It's like your toes barely in there. You know what I'm saying? And that's it. It's a little touch of the water of heaven. And it doesn't go any deeper. And then you jump into earthly things head first. And you wonder why this glory's never touched you. You look from a distance. People stand way out. They're not even in the court of the Gentiles. They're way, way out where the heathen stand, looking at the temple and the glory. Father's called us to come into the holies of holies. I'm not even staying in the holy place. The holy place was that place reserved for those special anointings in the old covenant. Hallelujah. Now with boldness we come in by the blood of the Lamb, not once a year. Woo! I tell you, it's a beautiful reality when your eyes are open to understand by the Spirit of wisdom and revelation that the holies of holies has moved into your very own life, that the power of God resides on the inside of you, that this is a treasure, far greater riches than anything that you could lay up for yourself in this earth, that this wonderful thing that God has done and is doing absolutely takes place and is executed in our life by the power that is in us. Now unto Him who is able to do far above, exceedingly far above, super abundantly, beyond all that we could think or ask according. The other night I was preaching in a church, and I said, now unto Him who's able to do super abundantly above all that we would think or ask, after we cry out to God and beg Him to rend the heavens and come down. And most of the people in the building were nodding their head, yes, amen, praise God. First of all, they do err not knowing the Word of God. Second of all, and probably bigger, is that that's the way most people live it. They're waiting for God to do something that He's already done. That's called doubt and unbelief. They're waiting for God to do something that He's already done. I'm going to tell you, Father has put in the church people like me to perfect you. In what way? To harass you mentally? To constantly tell you you're not standing in the blocks right, your not form's not right, your posture's not right. No, to get after you about how to move and function and receive and yield to the wonderful things the Father wants to give you and flow through you and produce in you, because that's where the change is. Where the change is. Now listen, turn me up a little bit. Now listen to me. When you think about that the church is supposed to be the fullness of Him that filleth all things, imagine how frustrated and upset the Holy Ghost is because we're willing to be content with something less. I'm going to say it to you again. When God's church is supposed to be the fullness of Him that filleth all things, how outraged would you imagine the Holy Spirit would be if you and I were willing to be content with something less? Now you understand me. Now you understand people like me, who've been taken over by the Spirit of grace, who's come with the Spirit of the Lord, with the zeal of the Lord that has consumed our very being, to see His house straightened out, to see all that God has done, to see the love of Christ which passes knowledge, which He gave to us through His only begotten Son, come and allow us to step in to all the fullness of Him that filleth all things. Hallelujah. Now, the love of Christ, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and thereby. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, people sit with their mind and they think and they try to judge based upon their understanding some one-sided perspective of things. I'm telling you right now, when you step over and you're willing to walk in the Word and live in the Word and not compromise the Word for anything. Father said, hate mother and father and brother and sister and everything in this life compared to doing His will and walking in His way and laying hold of the things which He's leading us to do. People want us to join up with them and their ideas. People charting their own course when God, the Holy Spirit, wants to lead us into the abundance of God's divine grace and life. Hallelujah. 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 That's right. That's how the church started. That's the church. I can't help it about the false models. I can't help it that people don't understand that, that they want something else. That somehow, because if they have something else, somehow they're going to be able to reach more men and attract more men. Well, they're not. They're not. They're not reaching more men and attracting more men. Why don't we just attract the Holy Ghost? Why don't we attract the Spirit of the Lord and allow Him to do whatever He wants to do in us? Hallelujah. And watch Him erupt on the scene. Watch Him explode on the scene. Watch Him come and be manifested. Hallelujah. Mankata, that's it. Hallelujah. You know what? Staying joyful and happy is an indicator that you're doing what God says to continually give thanks and praise. Hallelujah. It is an indicator that you're allowing faith to flood through you, the Holy Spirit to rule you, because that's what He does, the Spirit of grace, that's what He does. Hallelujah. Na Monday upon her. Ha ha ha. Hallelujah. See, right now I see some of you coming more into praise than you were when we were singing. Huh? Because we've got wrong ideas, we got wrong concepts, we got wrong models. Let's take the model that God gave to us when the glory came upon the tabernacle and Moses couldn't go in because the glory was too strong. When the glory came upon the temple that Solomon built and no one could stand to minister because the presence of the Lord had taken up over the place when they were gathered on that day of Pentecost, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, clothed in tongues of fire, came and rested on each one of them. Come on now. Come on now. Nandaya Shaya. Mahana. Mahana. Mahanaya Shaya. Boturi Sapati Sebayola Posipataya Remangata. Mana la mano secret take home. Hallelujah. That's praise. That's praise. That's praise. Mazana. You get to dance more. You can dance around a little bit more. Hamanana se ke la bo se kare mahana de yo hano se ke da mahana de he se la mahana hane he mohora bo si freve katu ya bro bo ho ho mana ya da bo se freve ka ile e be ke ya hallelujah hallelujah masoto ro mahana hallelujah hallelujah Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now this stuff about only 10% of the people in the meeting getting touched by the power of God. Look, I traveled with almost every person you can name that God has raised up over the past 30 years. And I've watched it over and again. It's a great night when 25%, 30% of the people receiving either miracle or healing or just receiving the outworking of the Holy Ghost. While 70 to 80% of the people just sit by and are spectators. It's a rare event. It's a rare event. It's a rare event. But you know what we want? You know what I'm striving for here? That in the morning you can wake up, get out of your bed, and immediately hook up with the realms of heaven, because if you do and you learn how to, it'll get stronger every day. It'll get stronger every day. Then you'll begin to understand this way other things of the Spirit. Then you'll be able to understand what it means to be more than an overcomer. And there's nothing more important to Father than you and I understanding how to live that. How to have the Word of God abiding in us and conquer Satan at every point. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord of glory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord of armies. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, our great salvation. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, the Lord of armies. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for the great outpouring. Hallelujah. I am in expectation for an overwhelming demonstration of the glory and the power of God that shocks even the Christian. The shocks that overwhelms, that causes even those who know the Lord to say, I can't believe that I've been in such doubt, that I was so distant I didn't really understand all these things of this glory and this presence of the living God, and all what it's going to do to a lost and dying world who's going to scream to the top of their lungs and come running. Hallelujah. Mambanda sekeya pahara. Hallelujah. Mambanda sekeya pahara stahia. Hallelujah. Listen to me. Listen to me. Sit down. Have a seat. Listen to me. Those of you especially that are from India, I'm getting ready to go to India. I'm getting ready to go. I'm going to go into Hyderabad, and I'm going to go to two villages about 4 hours away from Hyderabad that I cannot even pronounce. Then we're going up to the Kashmir Valley. People who come from a Hindu religious background or from that culture, you have to get out of yourself, because you've got even that much more problems of not wanting to go with emotionalism and passionateism. And now the Greek theology of Socrates and Aristotle came over into the church doctrine in the 3rd and 4th century. And they made, just like in Hinduism, because there is a kinsmanship between Hellenism, the Vedic Brahmanism, and Hinduism. They all came from the same devil. They all came from the same angel. And you can't have any passion, you can't have any emotion, you gotta shut all that down. That's anti-God, because I want to help you understand something. When you look in the scripture and you look in John chapter 7, it's very important for, I'm believing for a great outpouring of the Holy Ghost in India. Listen, can you imagine someone in a remote village 4 hours from Hyderabad saying, we're going to do a crusade, there's going to be 20,000 people in the crusade, at least, minimum, and I'm paying for everything. So, Pastor, when you get here, all you have to do is land. We're picking you up. And I said, no, let me take care of my hotels and stuff, because I want to make sure I get a right place so that Ann and I can sleep, because we don't just sleep anywhere. We'll stay awake. I mean, we'll do it. We're willing to accommodate anything, but we just won't sleep. Okay. Now, there's rare times where Father allows me to sleep in that kind of a situation. But Ann, we're just going to have to get a miracle for her, because she's got hypersensitive hearing and seeing, and hallelujah. Glory to God's all over you. Isn't that beautiful? I just love that. I'm about to jump up. I'm about to jump up and touch the ceiling right now. Hallelujah. Just looking at you. Takashi Vanahata. Hallelujah. Praise God. And then it's, you know, it's amazing. It's amazing. Isn't that amazing? You know, most of what you got going on out there is people trying to get you to come so that they can do a crusade, set up a crusade, and they can make a little bit of money off the deal. That's a lot of what the way things work. But you know what? God's got great plans for India. God's got great plans for America, but we got to get out our stuff and get into what he's doing. We've got to look at Pentecost and say, that's what Father wants. That's what he wants. That's what he means when Paul said, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourself. That's what he means when he said, build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. That's what he means when he says to us that we are supposed to desire spiritual gifts. That's what he means. He means that wonderful realm of glory. And it's not going to happen because you're sitting around staring. It's going to happen because all of a sudden you hear the word of God, you recognize what Father wants to do with your life, and all of a sudden you begin to respond with faith and want it. That's called hunger. See, because what happens when the word of God comes, one or two things are going to happen. You're either going to get hungry or you're going to get discouraged. You're going to get discouraged when you look to yourself. When you try to make it happen, when you look at yourself and you see what you are about, what you can do, what, huh? Come on now.
Listen, my. We got to make God bigger than he is, because he's way, way bigger than we believed. Amen. Hallelujah. You get discouraged because you look back on the past. You look back and turn into a pillar of salt thinking about all your failure. Or you look at your inability you tried before, but you've not laid hold on of it, and so you're predicting the future that you're still not going to be able to get it. Or you recognize, wait a minute, this is what Father has. You take the faith that Father has given you. You respond to him with it. And you say, Lord, I want this more than anything. I know that you exist, and I know that you're here. Say, I know that you exist.
I know that you exist.
And I know that you're here. No, that used to be, a big banner for me, back, when I first started ministering about 34 years ago. Hebrews 11:6. For without faith it is impossible to please God, because they that come to him must believe that he exists. Must believe that he exists. It's a state of being, the is word, exist. Hallelujah. And that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. That's the way it works. People want to have God. They want to have the glory of God, the things that they're scribing to the word. With this doing their own thing, charting their own course, not seeking him. God wants diligence. He wants it day in and day out. He wants you to come to a place where you don't weary in well-doing. I'm going to tell you right now, he wants you to come to a place where, you reap because you didn't faint. And the weary and the faint part could easily happen, because there's sometimes a period of time where Father develops us, where he examines us, where he wants bold prayer, petitioning prayer. He wants those kind of things that lay hold upon him, don't let up. Hallelujah. He wants somebody on the door banging and saying, get up, get up, get up. I need, get up, get up. Hey, hey, I know you're in there. Luke chapter 11. Get up, get up. He's not going to get up because he's a friend. He's going to get up because he's going to have to continue to listen to this all night. Get up! The boldness. He does not rise because he's a friend, but because of the boldness. Jesus saying, Father wants boldness. He wants to see some passion. He wants to see some expectation. He wants to see somebody who's confident, who knows that he will do what he said he would do, that he is so easy that he's looking for somebody who believes him to the point of pressing it all the way to a widow who comes and wearies him continually. Huh? She doesn't give him, the judge doesn't respond. And the hyperbole is, the judge doesn't respond because he loves men or fears God. Huh? But because he's constantly being wearied. My God, his Father said, I want you to weary me. Because all that says is, I know in whom I have believed. That's what that says. I know that you're there and that you're hearing me. I know what your will is and what your attitude towards me is. I have no condemnation, no fear, no shame, no guilt. It's been all removed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going to take hold of that thing that you said I could have. I'm going to stand up and fight the good fight of faith. And having done all to stand, I'm going to stand in you. I know who you called me to be and what you desired to take place in my life. And I'm not backing down. Father gets a big giant smile on his face. Says, I got myself a partner. I got myself somebody who's going to believe me. I got myself somebody who's going to come to know me. Hey, Abraham had no problem with sacrificing Isaac. He knew who God was. He knew the love of God, the benevolence of God, the goodness of God. There's no problem. To take everything that he had that was precious and dear to him and trust it in the Father's hand, because his keeping is far better than our keeping of our stuff. You let God keep your stuff, I'm telling you right now. Hallelujah. Good hands. There in John chapter 7, I want you to look. Come on, Patana. Kapatakamo shikika tapahakate. Mati ikina sikapa. Huh? Balanda de patast. I was listening to myself on a tape somebody posted the other day, and I was speaking the language of the Spirit. And I was so caught away, some different things were happening, and I didn't interpret. Because interpretation of tongues comes as easy as the tongue, as the language, it does. But I could hear it, and it was done many years ago. It was done probably 4 or 5 years ago. I could hear Father saying, now come to me. This is the way that I petitioned you to come and present yourself, so that I can respond to you and fill you with all the things that I've described and told you in my word. Hallelujah. Yeah, see, we want to have it one way, oh God. We want you to do it our way. And what is our way? It's based upon false models and ideas and pretense and things that we think and things that we've heard, because we've not been trained and molded and shaped and filled with his word. It's seeking God by new order. Listen, I've been in the church all my life. I've watched all kinds of preachers preach different kinds of things, and people believe all kinds of different things. But you know what? From time to time, I've seen the glory work, and I'm going, oh, look at here. See, that how that works right there. What are they doing? Oh, they're doing the word. What are they doing? Oh, they're doing faith about the Holy Ghost. Who? They're doing faith about the things of Pentecost, wanting what God described and said in John chapter 7 and verse 37, 38, and 39. Jesus cries out, because here they're going through the religious process. There seems to be a lot of hunger. You know, Josephus said, if you went to the Feast of Tabernacles, you would see the greatest celebration and display of ecstasy and joy that was upon the face of the earth. All in a religious thing. But oh, there's still glory in it. There's still glory in it. Even when God's people get happy about something religious and start shouting and get excited, even though it's just a form, is there still glory in it when it's directed towards heaven? But what happens when it's filled with the Spirit? What happens when it's real, when it's true, when it's born out of relationship? Who? It'll rend, it'll shake the earth. It will rend the earth. God's people calling out to heaven saying, rend the heavens. God's calling out to us and saying, you rend the earth. Hallelujah. I want you to start. I want you to lift up your voice with a shout, and the walls will come down. I want you to begin to work. I want you to begin to worship me and praise me, and the chains will fall off, and the earth will shake with the power of your praise and faith. Oh yeah, and the jail door will flop, but will not just open up. It'll fall down, come off its hinges. Hallelujah. I discovered it. I was really extremely sick one day. I was so sick. I was sick from the top of my head to the soles of my feet. I mean, my eyebrows were aching. My eyelashes were aching. I mean, I was so sick. And I was laying there going, oh, God, you know, just so sick. It was many years ago. I mean, it was 1986. I mean, I was so sick in 1986. And all of a sudden, the scripture went through my head, and Jacob laid a dying, rose up, leaned upon a staff, and worshipped. Huh? I realized that when the Spirit of the Lord spoke that scripture to me, that Jacob lived many years after he got up and worshipped. So I got up, and it was hard for me to get up. And oh God. That was about all I could pull out. I got, oh God, Jesus. And then it went from there. And within just a little bit of praising, it wasn't long at all, less than a minute, I was completely healed from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet. I started jumping up and down, screaming, hollering, worshiping, dancing around. I discovered how to break the hold of sickness. I discovered how to break the hold of being tired. I discovered how to be refreshed to God at any time. Man, the day of Raha. I fell in love with praise. I fell in love that much deeper with prayer and with just enjoying his presence. I found that provision works in the same way. When provision came threatening, saying, I'm going to take your head and feed your body to the beast of the field and the fowl of the air. You start doing that for a while, it looks like you're dancing, don't it? True. I know it looks wild to you, but this is a spiritual realm. You don't realize that there's angels, fallen angels right now, and demon spirits, principalities and powers that are doing everything they can possibly do to oppose the expression of the glory of God through you and me. When we talk about, oh God, I want to increase in anointing, all we're saying is I want Jesus Christ to be manifested, his life and power through me in a greater way. And all hell and all the powers of hell and every demonic force in this world is opposed to that, and we'll stop it with whatever tactic they can use that will work against you. When we say, no, God, I want to increase in the anointing, all we're saying is, Holy Spirit, I want you to have a greater liberty to flow through me with greater force, every part of me. And you don't recognize that you're in a battle. You don't recognize that you've got to contend for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. You don't recognize that you have to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might and take unto yourself what he has, his whole armor, his whole power and ability. Because you wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness. People don't realize it. They think, oh, this is just how I feel. No, it is not. It's an oppressive force of hell that is against everything that God wants to express through you and me. If I can just get people, that's why I like Friday Night School of the Spirit. Because, and if you've not come, or if you haven't come recently, I mean, you know, this past Friday night before, the meeting could have gone on all night. The Holy Ghost and the richness of the presence of the Spirit of the Lord. And if you haven't been, we got them on YouTube. There's, I don't know how many, there's probably 20, 30 of them there. Just listen to them, because it's all about you and me learning how to participate with the Holy Ghost and let Him move through every part of our being. And it's an active participation. And sometimes you got to run through a troop, and sometimes you got to leap over a wall, and sometimes you got to take on a giant. Huh? But we're not talking about weeks. It didn't take that long to go down into the valley with the rock. It didn't take that long. Less than a half a day, probably less than an hour. Pah! Done. Now let's move on. Now let's advance the things of the kingdom. Huh? Now let's step into even a greater anointing. People don't want to have to engage this realm. They want to leave their life to happenstance and circumstance and say, if it be thy will. They don't know anything about the will. I hear people talk about the will of God. God's will never be expressed outside of His Word. His Word describes His will. You can't say you're doing the will of God and not doing the Word. When you do the Word and you have to fight all hell to do the Word, I'm telling you right now, the captain of your salvation comes stand with you. And when as soon as he begins to expose himself just a little bit through you, all hell flees away. They flee. Yeah, that's why the scripture says, submit yourself to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. Because they flee in terror. The demon spirits are afraid of you and me. We are the testimony of their definite and certain judgment. And they want to shut that testimony down. They want to say, you're not going to testify that I'm going to be destroyed in hell forever. I'm going to stop the appearance and the glory of that which has defeated me at Calvary's cross, when Christ Jesus made open display and demonstration that all the powers and hosts of heaven were spoiled and their judgment stood forever. That's what you and I look like to hell. Well, no wonder they react like that to you and me. You just got to understand how not to let them touch you. Huh? You just got to understand how to live in the glory, how to live in this place. Of the fire of God, of the presence of the living God. I mean, Job just had a little hedge. You and I have been baptized in the very presence of Almighty God, the Holy Ghost. The most sacred, the most utmost. I'm telling you right now, you start staying with the Holy Spirit, you won't participate with demon spirits. Religion knows nothing about living free from sin. They're intimidated by it. They're intimidated by the idea. They're offended by the ideal of so living completely sold out to God. Mandeke. But it's too bad. I'm telling you right now, you and I can actually live in the heaven that we want to die and go to. It's called joy unspeakable and full of glory. It's called peace that passes all understanding. It's called love that goes beyond all knowledge. Hallelujah. It's called living and abiding in Him, Him dwelling in us, and we're dwelling in Him. It's the rivers of God. It's the expressions of heaven. It's all the nature and character and disposition of His splendor and majesty. No, there's going to be a day that just will come up when you hear that. Yeah. You're going to grow. You're going to grow and you're going to mature to where that when you hear that coming out of someone's mouth by the Spirit of the Lord, it activates within you an explosion of divine grace. You're not going to be so isolated. You're not going to be in a remote place, but you're going to be right up here in the face to face with the Almighty, with the Majesty. Earthly things will lose its interest. Huh? People will get wisdom and understanding to recognize that Satan knows when God's about to use you in a glorious outpouring of His Spirit. He will come with the forces, and he comes with the forces of hell to try to stop you down, to try to compromise the anointing in your life through sin. To try to invalidate your authority as a son of God because he was able to pull a string in your life or do something to make you subservient to his realm, which hinders the flow of the Holy Ghost. God's love and grace and mercy is always there. People take God's moving upon their life and His grace as an approval. It's not an approval. It's a call. It's a long-suffering. It's God's continual reaching out to us. My goodness, people have known what they've known in the realms of not walking faithful to God. Just imagine what you can have. Just imagine the heavenly realm that you can live in, the glory that you can experience, should you be willing to give yourself completely over to interacting with the Holy Ghost all day long. I want you to understand that we're the first expressions of the rivers come from. Jesus said, if anybody's thirsty, come to me and I'll give you the drink. Ah, my mother. Ataseteya. And he says this. He says, out of your belly. He didn't say out of your heart. He didn't use the Greek word for heart. He didn't use the spirit. He didn't use the Greek word for spirit. He didn't use soul. He didn't use the Greek word for soul. There's a lot of Greek words that he could have used that would be an expression of worshiping the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, with all your very, your tov, meod, the good things, the meod, the good things. Hatakiniya shikavataya, haramosipikaya. Hallelujah. Said out of your belly. It's a Greek word. It's a very rare Greek word. Jesus grabbed it and used it. It's a very rare word. Even in Attic Greek, it has a very specific meaning. It was used in the clinical setting to talk about your colon. But we know that the Lord's not having anything to do with colon over here. Hallelujah. So we know it doesn't mean that any more than when he talks about our heart, he's not talking about the pump. Huh? You with me? In the Hebrew language, God says he tries our liver. We know he's not talking about our liver. But that's the word that's used, liver. He tries our liver. And we know what it means. We know that it means he's trying our attitudes, our reins, what controls us, what moves us. He's trying us. Are you moved by fear, or are you going to let love overwhelm you? Are you moved by your own opinion, or are you going to let my word dominate you? I mean, I could go on and on about various different words that are used to express a spiritual state, a response, or attitude within the life. But kolia is very unique. The word is inescapable in Attic Greek. It means emotions and passions. It means nothing else. And you know what? The Lord has so set it up to where people can now go check up on these things like never before. Even though you have Greek scholars around you, you can go find for yourself. You can just go take a good program of Greek and English, biblical program, and you can point and click. You can say, what does this word mean, kolia? And it's going to tell you, it's going to give you the literal meanings, and then it's going to tell you what it means in Attic Greek or by a simile or an allegory or an idiom of Greek, of the Greek language or the Hebrew language. It means passions and emotions. So he said, out of your passions and your emotions shall flow rivers of living water. He's literally saying unlimited expressions, a force that goes beyond just saying unlimited expressions. He's saying rivers of living water. He's talking about an unlimited power that will sweep you away. That will sweep you away. And people say, well, if that's true, then why isn't it happening to me? It can't be true because it doesn't match our experience. No, you're processing wrong. You've got to be willing to let your experience match the word. God's not going to conform to you. The scripture doesn't say Christ Jesus will conform to you. It says for you to conform to Christ Jesus. The scripture doesn't say Christ Jesus is going to put you on. It says you're supposed to put him on. People talking about a mantle of Elijah. How about the mantle of Jesus? Because when we say put on, that particular word, enduo, this is the Greek word, enduo, it literally means it's a cloak. It's a special cloak. Special cloak. Shabbat. Halamakaya. Asupane epikeya. Hopane epikeya. Every single day. Not just sometimes. I did it 20 years ago. 20 years ago, no matter nothing. Two days ago doesn't matter anything. It's learning how to walk in the Holy Ghost continually. It's learning how to be continually filled with the Spirit. It'd be like somebody said, oh, well, I sang a hymn. I did a psalm, a hymn, and a spiritual song 20 years ago. You'd be looking at them like, what? Are you kidding me? Huh? That'd be like somebody saying, I was filled 20 years ago. I hear people say all the time, oh, man, when I was first baptized in the Holy Ghost, I lost the English language. I lose the English language every day. But it isn't because I'm somebody unique or special. It's because I demand it. It's because I go over into that realm. Because I take my whole body and my being and I present it to God. I say, light it up with your glory. I don't even have to say that. I just, by the act of doing it, he lights it up with his glory. And the more you give yourself every day to this outworking of his presence in your life. I mean, God wants to come to you and he wants you to have an encounter with his glory that's like the force of rivers. He hits you. If you've ever been in the desert when there's a flash flood, it's trouble, ain't it? Because when that water sweeps down into those ravines, in Hebrew language we call it wadis. When the water sweeps down into those ravines, if you're standing there, you can get swept off your feet. It comes like a flood. It comes sometimes a wave of a foot, 2 foot deep. That'd take you. That's just a wadi. That's just a stream. That's just a little wash. Huh? Ann and I was standing in front of the Zambezi the other day. In Victoria Falls. And I said, that's what it looks like the Holy Ghost coming on me right now. Hallelujah. That's a spiritual impact. I mean, if you could, your eyes could be open, you could see the glory and the spiritual impact coming to you and through you. Instead of just seeing all the things that you quantitate and measure on an earthly dimension. Listen to me. Sutake. Listen to me. Hallelujah. You'd be excited about what's going on in your life. Then when you take that and measure it, put it together with Victoria Falls, and what's another big fall? Niagara. Yeah. Well, Victoria was Niagara. Put Victoria and Niagara together. See, can we come up with another one? Huh? We've got to take all those, put them together, and we've got some rivers now. Is God a liar? Is he speaking in hyperboles there? It's not a place for a hyperbole. It's an exaggeration to make a point. When he likened himself unto a judge who fears not God nor regards men, that's a hyperbole. God taking an extreme opposite end of the spectrum to make a point about himself because he's just the opposite of that, you see? Hallelujah. Are you listening to me over here? There's no place for hyperbole. This is the reality. Over and again, God's talking to us about filling us with the fullness of his presence. You should be endued with power. Hallelujah. You should be endued with power so that you can continually be endued. Can you hear me? Huh? You should be endued with power so that you may be continually filled with the Holy Ghost. See, the arrogance of some people. I heard one of these presidential candidates say, I'm going to return the power to the church. Who do you think you are, you foul spirit of hell? You hear what I'm telling you? I mean, people are so arrogant in their thinking. They're just so full of doubt and unbelief in their thinking. Look at what Father has given to us. He's given us the power to redeem the times. Because the day is evil. We, not some legislative branch of government, not some judicial branch of government, not the forces of men with all their weapons. He has given to you and me the ability to redeem the times. But what happens is we have so much more than Daniel had, but we do less with it. We have so much more than Joshua had, but we do far less with it. It's about time that we allow God to begin to move in our lives and recognize that Father wants to raise up right now. He wants to raise up right now, Enochs. He wants to raise up right now, Elijahs. He wants to raise up right now, Moses, Daniels. But all of these guys baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire because their ministries were limited. Joseph says, you just tell me a dream. I know the one who is the interpreter of all dreams. Listen to the confidence. See, listen to the assurance. He's certified. He's got assurance. He's got confidence. And there's expectation. Those are the ingredients of faith that comes out of relationship because every day you say, Holy Ghost, take hold of me because you begin to enjoy and won't live without that which God has supplied. And because people are willing to live without, that's why they've never understood the life of the overcomer. They've never understood the life of the one who's more than a conqueror. It's just all been verses of scripture that maybe they've memorized or conceptualized, but they've never experienced because they've never allowed the force of the divine power and glory, the strength and the ability which only God can give to surge through their life by your own willingness to participate. God ain't going to come force himself on us. Huh? And then when you begin to think about the hindering forces of hell that God will allow hindering spirits. He will allow temptation. He does. Even though he's come with a new covenant that causes us to walk, causes us, and the word is almost to make us to walk in his statutes and his judgment, that he's written his law upon the tables of our heart and upon our mind. He's established his word that we may do those things which he has spoken and commanded. That's what all the prophets said. That's what all prophets said. Jeremiah 31, 33, Ezekiel 20, 36, 26, Hebrews 8, 10, Hebrews 10, 16. And I could go on. I'll just give you four right there. That's enough you need. That's enough. That should establish it. Huh? People do err not knowing the word of God. They err. They err. Not understanding the word of God, listening to all the various different ideas, which basically people have just made a bunch of heresies, and they've spoken lies so long that it's become the truth. The Father's got himself some champions that he's raised up, and I'm believing God that you'll let him raise you up even more. God, somebody said, God, pick me. He's picked you. Now start participating. He's already picked you, man. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As many as received him, as many as received what he's given, he gave you the authority to be a son of God. Hallelujah. I'm Bangladesh. Somebody said, who do you think you are? I don't think. I know. I'm a son of God. I've been redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ. I've been born of the Holy Spirit. The very power of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost lives on the inside of me. Who are you? What are you doing? You know, Paul's always like, even when people who are misbehaving, he says, listen, I'm not going to come to you and hear what all you got to say. I'm going to come see your power. Get ready. Get ready, because I'm coming. I want to see a display of power. Get yourself ready. Pull your stuff. Get ready to operate in the skill sets that you've been taught in the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost passions. The first place that you've got to learn how to let the Holy Ghost move through you in the expressions of divine rivers is in your emotions and your passions. Come on, you're going to have to dance a little bit. You know, I love reading about and watching as closely as I can people who've stepped into greater anointings than the average and the you know, everyday run-of-the-mill Christian. I love reading about and examining people like Mariah Woodworth, Edder, and Wigglesworth, and others. I got a lot of folks, you know, that I just pay real close attention to what's going on in their life. You know, Wigglesworth, he got up in the morning and danced around. That's how he started his day. Got up and started dancing around. He's getting over into a place called thanksgiving and praise. With all prayer and supplication. See, with all prayer and pleadings, urgent pleadings in the Holy Ghost, watching thereunto with thanksgiving. Hallelujah. See, a thanksgiving is a praise. It's a dance. It's a joy. It's a rejoicing. If you're not willing to hook up with joy and rejoicing, you're not willing to hook up with the Holy Ghost. People, you let whatever state you're in rule you. I said it again. You let whatever state you're in rule you. Instead of conforming to Christ Jesus and conforming to his word and putting on the Lord Jesus Christ and looking in the mirror and seeing the glory and beginning now to live out and walk out who you are as God's covenant partner on the earth, to now be trained by the Holy Ghost to make the same choices that he chooses, to make the same decisions that he makes, to hear him say, son of man, what do you see? And you declare it and God makes it happen. To be able to bind on earth and he binds in heaven, loose on earth and he looses in heaven. To begin to live your life out saying, oh God, I want to fully live as your ambassador, is one reigning with you in this life right now. I don't want to have an inheritance that the earthly realm, that my realm of my birthhood could bring me from a human realm. I want all that you have given me when I was born of you. I want all that you have purposed me to be when you raised me up and set me in a heavenly realm with you. I want to live in the heavenly realm, see the heavenly realm. I want to define, process, interpret, view all life based upon that heavenly realm that you brought me into by the seeing of the Holy Ghost. Then the word of knowledge works. The word of wisdom works. The discerning of spirits work. Hallelujah. Bakata sepele kahaha. Hallelujah. You're able to see what people are, what's the results of people's lives before they do it. First and foremost, you're able to see the results of your life before you do it. It's a good thing to know how this is going to turn out before you decide. Every time you just obey God's word, real simple. I'm going to tell you right, you don't have to know. You already know how it's going to turn out because it's going to turn out to be a blessing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What happens if you'll hear the word of God today and say, oh, I got it. I cannot let sorrow, sadness, disappointment, discouragement, concern, worry, fear, stress, anxiety rule my spirit and my mind. And what's happened has become normal. You live in a normalized state of these things. Mm-hmm. To various different degrees. And thus it produces a frown in that look that you have on your face. That kind of sedate disposition that you have, that every once in a while you get happy because something is coming your way that you weren't expecting, that is purely natural and human. That is hectic. In all of the definition of the word, that is a terrible, abusive way to live. Huh? What happens when all of a sudden you say, no. I'm going to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. I'm going to give myself over to the Holy Ghost. Sedate is not a fruit of the Spirit. Depressed is not a fruit of the Spirit. Depressed is actually an expression of a demonic power at work in your life. There's oppression, depression. We talk about the fact that the prince of the power of the air can affect people in temptation. Then we talk about something that gets more than just temptation. It's oppression. Then we go something deeper than oppression. It's depression. And then we go something deeper than depression. It's called possession. All of it activities of demonic power that I'm at war against, huh? That when I see them coming, I pick up the chair and throw it at them, so to speak, in the spirit, huh? That I jump on them with all fours, man. I mean, it's heel, it's knee, it's elbows, it's fist, in the spirit. It's teeth, it's claws, it's everything in the spirit. I come at it with such forcefulness. Come on now. People sit there and entertain and let that evil spirit kind of hypnotize them and lure them into the deception of iniquity, to be bit of its poison when they reach out to touch its pleasure. That's really nothing more than taking yourself a drink of pleasure from the septic system. The septic system of the spirit. Oh, when you can smell it. When you can see it for what it is. You'll cover that thing up. Hallelujah. I'm telling you this. I'm bringing it to you. That's the way it is. Quit sipping that stuff. Quit sipping that stuff. That's why you're sick. That's why you're sick in your spirit. People don't have strength because they don't have a good diet of the word. They don't even know what that is. They're so oppressed by the powers of darkness, they don't have time for the word. They're so oppressed by the circumstance and situation around them, they don't have time to go over here and start enjoying His presence. See, if I can teach people how to pray and hook up with this river and this flow of heaven just on the basis of teaching them how to enjoy the presence of the Lord, how to just lift your hands anywhere you at and just begin to let the pasatia roma makataya la mahaha overwhelm you. And it may start off like I was describing, where I was so sick I could barely go, oh God, Jesus. But I started. Huh? You got to start. Huh? And then how deep do you want to go? Because He's saying jump in. And it may be that you go, it may be that you just go toe deep. Oh, yeah, praise God. I had a toe deep meeting with God today. It got me through the day. Well, imagine what if you would have jumped in head first. Imagine what if you would have sunk to the bottom and breathed. Huh? Hallelujah. Imagine what would have happened if you had a Pentecost and got baptized in the Holy Ghost today. You know, baptism in the Holy Ghost is something that happens every day. People say to me, you know, what is the difference between being baptized and being filled with the Spirit? There is no difference. There is absolutely no difference. Jesus said, I'll show it to you just in two chapters, but I can prove it to you in many verses of Scripture. Jesus said, in Acts 1:5, He said, you should be baptized not many days from now. Huh? That's 1:5. 1:8, He said, tarry in Jerusalem till you are endued with power from on high. Huh? Then shall you be my witnesses. So He takes baptism and endowment from power on high, and it's already been equated, but He's going to equate Him again. And He talks about Him in baptism being not just a head dunk, not about one backwards, one forward, a sprinkle, or a dip. He's talking about rivers coming overwhelming you and coming on you and inside of you. Now what happens? What happens? He said, you're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days from now. He described it in Luke chapter 24 and verse 49. It says, tarry in Jerusalem until you receive the promise of the Father. Hallelujah. It's the promise of the Father. It's the baptism anointing. It's the endowment with power from on high. It's all these three things. Now look what happens. And it's more. Hallelujah. It's the rivers. And it's more. Hallelujah. Now, they were all filled with the Spirit. That's what Scripture says. Verse Acts 2, 4. He said, you're going to be baptized. But when the baptism come, God says, and they were filled with the Spirit. And he takes that exact same phrase, and Paul uses that exact same phrase in a number of different places, but especially one that you know, Ephesians 5, 18. Don't be drunk with wine, wherein there is debauchery, wherein is debauchery, but be filled. Same as baptized. Be baptized. Oh, God, I'm not ashamed. You mean I can have a Pentecost every day? Yeah, and as you do, Pentecost comes stronger and stronger and stronger. And the more you give yourself to minister before his presence because you took a hold of seek my face, seek my presence continually. Some people say, oh, some people just seeking God's presence, seeking his face. Absolutely. That's what exactly what he told us to do. It's to literally seek his existence in our life, his presence. Hallelujah. And as we do, what happens is that becomes more real to us. It becomes more effective in our life, the power and the glory of that realm. The faith increases in that realm to where we just instantly, whatever we need. I was sitting in a meeting not too long ago where I was preaching, and I was sitting on the front row, and I mean, I got there, I didn't have nothing. All I had was tired. And their worship service wasn't that good. But I can enter, you know, I can enter into worship even in the Vatican. You know? I you know what I do when I'm like at the store or at a coffee shop or wherever and they got music going? I change the words. I change them. I say, I'm worshiping the Lord. I change the words to, you know, something like, oh, worthy is the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the earth. I can just change the words. I can worship with anything. But I was just, you know, I was really just trying to intercede for these people so that they could get out of the slump kind of thing. And I really didn't have a lot. I didn't know what I was going to preach on. I'm there to preach. I know what I'm going to preach on. And I didn't have any inspiration. God, because I've come to learn how to live in the inspiration of the Holy Ghost. I don't want my own inspiration. Hallelujah. God comes and inspires me. But I did know how to hook up with him. And there's been times I've walked up on the platform. I walked up on a platform one time, and there was tens of thousands of people. I walked up on the platform. I didn't have anything. In fact, I was actually hurting in my body. I'd hurt my leg. And I walk up on the platform. I had nothing. I had nothing. I'm actually hurting. I walk up on the platform, and as soon as I got on the platform in the place that I'm supposed to be with God, I was immediately healed, and heaven came down upon me, and the glory was over. I mean, just floods of heaven right out of my mouth. So, I mean, I understand this. And so I'm never really too alarmed about the fact I don't know what I'm going to preach about or I don't have any inspiration. But I'm sitting there, I'm just kind of just, you know, thinking, you know. I try not to think about process what I could preach on, well, I could preach on this or that. I usually just shut that stuff down because that's my thinking. I don't want my thinking. Because if I'm going to go with my thinking, I've got to figure out the rest of it. If I'm going to go with my topic, I've got to figure out the points. You know what I'm saying? And I just don't like that. It's just like, that's boring anyways. And God, the Holy Ghost, hardly has any opportunity to move in the midst of that mess. The only thing good there is his word, as long as it's being spoken. But I said, Father, I thank you. Here's what I said, Father, I thank you that you exist, that you are. And then I said, and that you hear. And as soon as I did, I mean, I'm telling you right now, I had Pentecost right there on the front row. My face started beaming with light, with beams of light. I'm not kidding you. That's what it feels like. It feels that way. It feels that way to me. I'm sure it's that way if you can see it in the Spirit. I'm sure it's that way. And I want that, I'm telling you this because I want you to know there is a place of relationship that you can find with him, that you can access all the realms of his divine power and glory. Satan cannot stand against his glory. He cannot, not for a moment. You've got to make Jesus' obedience bigger than Adam's disobedience. Huh? Come on, listen to me. You've got to make the realms of the Holy Ghost and interacting with the realms of the Holy Ghost bigger than interacting with the realms with the demon spirits. Oh, everything becomes beautiful in the realms of this relationship when you learn how to let the Spirit of the living God flow through you. And are you going to deal with a lot of stuff? Yeah, you're going to deal with the lust of the flesh. Everything, every kind of pleasure that could potentially be experienced in the body and in the human frame. You're going to deal with the lust of the eye. That's everything that you could possibly desire that's pretty and shiny and bigger and nicer that you can use and have and play with and have fun with and do things with. Stacks of money, stacks of gold, and stacks of this and stacks of that, which you don't need, which will pierce you through with many sorrows. And now you're going to have to deal with the pride of life, stubbornness and rebellion. Don't want to be told what to do. You're going to figure it out your own way because God loves you as much as he loves anybody else. See, a little bit of truth, one-third truth, confirm a lie. You hear me? You show me people who've learned how to be servants, and I'll show you people who know how to receive from the Holy Ghost. Pop Seymour is one of the great examples of that. You show me people. And that was one, I think, one of the reasons that women tend to have easier to receive from things of the Spirit because they know how to be servitude. They know more about servitude. They know more about submission just naturally. Huh? And then, of course, society and culture has kind of set that up that way. Of course, the biggest thing that's going against women and being able to move in the Holy Ghost and have just a hard time is men, is feminism. Feminism is a rebellious defiance of demonic power that's all in the realms of the pride of life. It's one of the principalities. It's one of the angels that now rule in America. Feminism, humanism, and intellectualism. When I see it on a person, the deeper it's in them, the more I don't want them having any say over me. You hear me? I'd love for Ben Carson to be president. He's the most worthy candidate on the lineup right now. But you can see the spiritual condition of our nation. Everybody, Carly, Ben, Mike Huckabee, everybody who really had something valuable, something good, to stand for something that would really turn this nation. 1%, 2%, 3% in the polls. Huh? I think Ben got up to like, he was up pretty high to start with until he started talking too much about Jesus. Started quoting too many verses of scripture. It's okay. We'll turn this thing. If you'll start flowing in the Holy Ghost. Won't turn it in religion. Religion is, I'm going to come to church. Well, this is the best. Can I give you the best religion? Here's the best religion. I'm going to come to church so I can experience the move of God. And then many people, first of all, they drag all their stuff in, and somebody's got to have an anointing that is, I mean, just a, you know, a major anointing, get everybody happy by the end of the meeting. You know what I'm saying? Huh? And then we just go and do it all over again. People go back out, they compromise, they haven't had the river flowing to their life, the wellsprings flowing, the beauty of God flowing through their emotions, flowing through their passions. Guess what else is now in your emotions and passions? You're getting all clogged up by the stuff. Offense, attitudes, disappointments, you know, discouragement, fear. We're not supposed to live in that place of bondage, of fear. Everything about fear works opposite of everything about love. Everything in realms of fear will impose upon you doubt and unbelief. You're tied up. You're in prison now. You're tied up. You're bound hand and foot now. Huh? There ain't no way you can get out of that under the fear of it. It's where doubt and unbelief has complete and total authority over you. You've got to be willing to step in love. And love doesn't begin to be expressed outside of relationship with him. You've got to start enjoying the presence. You got to be able to lift your hands and just rejoice in God, your Savior, and thank him for all that he's done and begin to recognize the Holy Ghost. All you've got to do is agree with truth and start speaking truth. I'm telling you. And the power of the Spirit of the Lord will overwhelm you. And the more you let the Spirit of the Lord overwhelm you, the more capacity you have to receive. It's as though something is happening spiritually within our life that fully opens up the door to everything that Father has. So he can touch every part of our being. What part of your being do you want to keep isolated from the Holy Ghost? Tell me, what part of your being? What part of your being? And I want you to understand, it has to begin within, for greater is the one on the inside of us than the one on the outside. We have to understand that the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. He shall also make alive your mortal body. It's got to start within the inside. He's not going to give you a new body to start with. He gives you a new heart and a new spirit. The new body comes later. The effects of a new heart and a new spirit on the body is resurrection life, a resurrection life that brings healing now to your body, that brings strength to a tired body. Praying over these wrinkles and this hair loss. Jesus. Must it be, oh God? Father, can I grow old and still stay somewhat, you know, easy for me to look at in the mirror? Well, that's the process. Though my body, though my outward man perishes, my inward man is being renewed. Though my outward man, my outward body is going to the grave, because that's the context of what Paul is saying, my inward man is getting big, my spiritual man. I'm in every way maturing in that which I was born into. If you were born a chimpanzee, you can only grow up to be an adult chimpanzee. If you're born a human being, you can only grow up to be an adult human being. If you wanted to grow up and be a giraffe, I'm sorry. If you're born by the Spirit of God as a child of God, in the family of God, as heir of God and co-heir to a Jesus, brother to Almighty God, Christ Jesus, then you get to grow up into Him in all things. Just to use it the way Paul described it in Ephesians 4:15. I get to grow up into Him in all things. I get to fully mature. See, I've got a goal. I have a goal. People laugh at me, you know. But you know what? You can laugh all you want. You can say whatever you want. What's your goal? Let me hear what your goal is. Mine is exactly what the Scripture says, to come into the fullness of the measure, the maturity, the ministry of Jesus, even unto a fully matured man in the next 10 years. Well, now it's 9. Because I quit being intimidated. People say, you can't do it. Because everybody I've ever watched, and they're saying, you know, we're laying aside the weight and the sin is so easily beset us. They never stop doing that. They're doing that to the day they die. Why don't you get on with the program? You're telling me that we can't grow and mature? When God wants us to grow and mature? Oh, we can. If we go ahead and resign ourselves fully to be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, to go ahead and cross over and be completely His, to now no longer live unto ourselves, but unto Him who died and rose again for us, to find ourselves. See, people have a hard time going, I no longer live, it's Christ. They can't wrap their heart and head around it. See, because they're thinking it wrong and they're saying it wrong. What you've got to be able to think of and understand and begin to participate with and receive is, I've got the life of God. My life was changed. My life was put away by the reception of the life of God. I have the life of God. I have the life of Jesus. I got the life of the Holy Ghost. I got the life of the Father. I got the heavenly life. I've got the life that lasts forever. I got the life that is unending. I've got the life, hallelujah, that's called eternal life. I got the life of God. Now it's easy. I got the life of God. I no longer live. I got the life of Christ. I no longer live. I don't want to live. I don't want that life. And then all of a sudden, because of all the things we stacked on ourselves, I watch young men and young women who went to school not to get themselves a vocation, but somehow they said, well, I'm going to get a job temporary before I go to the mission field. Then they go get a job, and then somebody comes along as a counselor, ungodly counselor, says you need to buy a house. And now you need to buy a car. And now you need to build your credit. And inside of 2 years, they brought themselves into servitude and bondage for the next 35. And now they can't go to the mission field. That's not why they went to school. Huh? That's not why they participated with that process. Mm-mm. You hear me? And then they don't even go to school and they still get in there. Oh, they get a good job. Oh, you got a good job. Oh, you got things going for you. Now the counsel of the ungodly, go buy a house. Go get in debt. Go make yourself a slave to the system so that you cannot do what God wants you to do. Now you got to play make-believe and pretend and live on His mercy every day. God, I know that I'm doing it my own way. Can you give me another part of your will? Can I just participate and support the church? Oh, people don't do that. I know I have an answer that breaks that yoke, no matter how deep you got yourself into debt. I've got an answer that breaks off that yoke. That's be you. You begin to lift up your voice and cry out to God for deliverance. You begin to lift up your voice and you cry out to God and say, Father, I want to experience what it means to be baptized in the Holy Ghost and to walk in Christ Jesus and make no provision for the flesh. Hallelujah. And it's lust, because it's coming at me. It's coming at you. All that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. None of this belongs to the Father. It doesn't belong to heaven. It belongs to a demonic realm. It belongs to the prince of the power of the air, the god of this world, the spirit of disobedience that is at work in the children of disobedience. And more people that sit in church are involved with it and compromised with it. Constantly, they're being neutralized at best and usually assimilated. Here, born of God, heir of God, co-heir with Jesus, a person to be able to stand and bring heaven to men, to stand as a testimony that Christ Jesus is King of kings and Lord of lords, who has power and authority over all things. And now we've been neutralized by compromise. Yeah. By the cares, by the riches and the pleasures. CRP. I like to point that out. CRP keeps you from bringing forth. CRP. Everybody get it? Do I need to put the A in there? Okay. You're supposed to be able to leave out the vowels and everybody gets it. Some of you are looking at me. I know some people's second language. Don't bring forth fruit into perfection. Father wants us to bring forth fruit into perfection. There's got to be some people going to go ahead and step into the maturity. I haven't seen maturity. I've seen just people just getting in. I watch people get in ankle deep and knee deep. I even watch people jump in and swim around in the glory. And I'm thinking, my goodness, they all set up. Boy, what is the responsibility they have now? Because now they know exactly where to go to live at, to now mature into the riches of the expression of the very nature of Father's disposition and giftings that he's given to us to represent him with signs and wonders and demonstration of the power of the Holy Ghost. But more than that, the love, the joy, the peace, the kindness, the goodness, the godliness, the mercy, the long suffering, the temperance, the humility, the lowliness, things that the pride of life esteems as no value at all. But in the realms of heaven, it's the differences whether or not you're going to be able to yield to the Holy Ghost or not. Lowliness and meekness. Jesus said, come learn me. I'm going to show you how this works. I'm going to show you how the anointing is able to flow through me, so to me, and through me. Let me show you. Come sit down here. I'll wash your feet. One day the Lord's going to have us all come sit at the table, the marriage supper of the Lamb. He's going to make everybody sit. He's alone. We'll be serving. He will take the towel of a servant, and you wait on us. Hallelujah. Pakasita rata. Hallelujah. Roast lamb and potatoes. I don't know what's all on the menu, but it's going to be good. It's the marriage supper. It's the marriage supper. We've been presented unto Christ, espoused unto Christ as chaste virgins. We are already married. We've been espoused unto him. Espoused, married, espoused. I know King James traps people sometimes, and then when people try to go with some of these new translations, it even takes the word of God sometimes even more in hostage. But espoused. It's more than just the engagement. Hallelujah. The marriage supper of the Lamb takes us to a place. A.B. Simpson got a hold of it. I like to talk about what God says to other men. A.B. Simpson got a hold of it. John G. Lake described it. To be married unto God. A city four square. Got to be careful what we say. It's too much for people to bear. The glory of heaven. Jesus having reproduced his life in us. The New Jerusalem, the bride of Christ. Hallelujah. Everybody from Abel until the last one standing. Thank you, Jesus. Mondereste, the giftings of God, the great things that Father would do. But you have to be willing to stop. You can't have you in heaven too. But oh, when you begin to look upon that wonderful place, that wonderful realm, that prasaya, it becomes more important to you and more valuable to you than all other things. When you begin to gaze upon his life is more precious to you than your life. And suddenly your life doesn't dominate anymore. Your will doesn't dominate anymore. Amen. There's the first place that God's glory wants to flow through you in immeasurable expressions, your emotions. That's where the love will be developed. That's where the gentleness will be developed. Your passions. That's where the love will be developed. That's where the joy will be developed. That's where the deep, as Paul said, deep bowels of compassion. Once again, using a very close word related to kolia, the depths of your bowels, the deepest part of your spiritual being, the depths of your emotions, once again, the deepest recess of your emotions. There's things about joy and peace and love and goodness and humility and kindness that all display the character and nature of God that you've never touched, because only your yieldedness to the Holy Ghost can express it. You can't access it. You barely can access a little happy. I tell people all the time, I want to show you how much control over you have over yourself. Okay, you ready? Put your hand out. Put your hand down. Everybody do this. Put your hand down. Wiggle your fingers. Look at that. That's how much control you have over that smile, over that disposition. But people can't do it. They can't do it. What's wrong? Well, I'm looking for some inspiration. I know where the place of rivers of inspiration is. I know where rivers of inspiration are. Can you hear me? Listen to me. People, I want you to tell you something. The church, us, we're supposed to be the fullness of Him that filleth all things. Listen, I want you to look at this scripture. I'm going to read this scripture to you, and then Ephesians 1. This will only happen because you're willing to do it. I'm not preaching to you to excite your intellect, to give you some kind of unique revelation that you can paint a picture about or write a poem of or tell somebody, oh, you should have been in the meeting today. It was amazing. Pastor unveiled the eighth wonder of the world in such a simple and easy way to explain. I'd rather to understand. But then people don't do anything with it anyways, right, in that realm. But today, if you grab a hold of this and begin to say, Father, I'm beginning to enjoy your presence. See, we're talking about relationship now. We're talking about where love begins to flow, where love begins to overwhelm your life in such a way that faith works and doubt and unbelief can't get near you, that fear can't, and perfect love casts out all fear, you see. See, this is what the Lord wants. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 22, the scripture says, and he has put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that fills all things. See, all of a sudden now we can make disciples out of nations. Now we can bind and loose, and it happens. Now all of a sudden the glorious kingdom of God is revealed in the midst of the earth, as it was in the days when there was only 120 people in the church. You hear me? So what if we allow in our spirit, in our thinking, our disposition, in our behavior to accommodate anything less than that? What if you try to explain a different state of a church and then function in a different state of a church? Outrages the Holy Ghost. Now you understand why there must be correction in the church. Now you understand why there has to be someone that's putting forth the charge of the Lord Jesus Christ and the purposes of the Father, who's jealous over the things that belong to his Son. Come on, people. You got to quit allowing something less than a church being other than what God described. And you have to recognize this one thing. You listen to me. You individually. You listen to me. You individually. Right now, you individually. Each one of us individually. We decide how much that glory of heaven is going to flow out of our life, because it's the church, the glorious church, is made up of you. And you're going to walk in here with your frowns and your discouragements and all your compromises, all your CRP. Huh? Literally, I can say with all your crap, cares, riches, and pleasures. Say it with a smile. It goes over better. And think that somehow that's acceptable to God? It outrages the Holy Ghost. See, there needs to be a fear of God in our life. There needs to be an understanding of what Father wants. And then there needs to be a willingness to have a relationship with him to receive the empowerment to do what he wants. Because God's never commanded us to do anything that he didn't empower us with the ability to do it. He says, here, this is what I want you to be. I want you to glorify me in your body and your spirit. So you go, oh my goodness, how am I going to do that? I already had enough job as it was. No, it is an empowerment message. I'm going to give you the ability. He says, be holy even as I'm holy. You got to be kidding me. How am I ever going to do that? Like, you're holy, there's no one as holy as you. See, that means that you're not even supposed to do it. No, wrong conclusion. It's a gift. He gives it to you. Now you get to participate with. You're empowered. I get to be as holy as he is. I get to be as righteous as he is. That's what the scripture says. He that does righteousness is righteous even as he is righteous. Read it, 1 John 3:7. That's what he says. You go, oh my goodness. No, you're not supposed to be looking to your own human ability. Listen to me. It's the divine power that flows to us and starts in our emotions and our passions. This is where you first learn to flow with the rivers of God. People look at us getting ecstatically joyful, losing the English language, walking around as drunk men laid out under the power of God, because our emotions are just, you know, caught away. Our passions are caught away in heaven. And they're going, oh, that's a demonic power. What do you have with that frown on your face? What's that? What's that with that lack of faith? You haven't gone anywhere, done anything in the kingdom of God. What's that? Come on, bring your problems, bring your issues, bring your criticism, bring your comments. Because we're going to get up off the floor having rolled around being holy rollers. Huh? We're going to stop after we run around a couple of times and dance a couple of times. And I know the other night, I know that that doesn't show up good on the film. I was dancing like everything, every part of my body was dancing. That doesn't look good, but when we walk out of it, miracles happen. You know, I was so blessed because I was just reminded, Angela and Paulina posted the YouTube the night that their mother got a new heart. And it's probably, I don't know what, 6 years ago or something like that. And it was, I mean, that night, because I looked at it, they didn't show it on that clip. I think they had about an hour and a half clip or whatever. That night, I mean, I was basically doing backflips in the Holy Ghost, you know, worshiping. Because when people look at it and go, oh man, he's a wild man. Oh, that's a little bit overboard. Oh, that's a lot of emotion and passion. That's kind of ugly, so much emotion and passion. It's like letting down your hair and snot and tears coming out on the feet of Jesus, and you're wiping them with your hair of all things. Why can't you get something? At least wipe it with your sleeve, your hair, my goodness. But what happens when you come out of that? Signs, wonders, miracles. Huh? Because the passions and the emotions were caught away in glory. Now all your life is, your whole being's taken over. Because he inhabits that kind of praise. He hooks up with that kind of a realm. people, it looks weird to people, but I'm telling you right now, the world can't know us, can't understand us, can't relate to us. They can only get happy about immorality and demonic power and evil workings. We're over here caught away in the purity and the holiness and the righteousness and the glory and the splendor of a love relationship with a Father who blesses us with His presence that's more than you can handle. I mean, I'm laughing, crying, shouting, singing all at the same time. You know what I'm saying? And it's wonderful when a person who's got a pacemaker, whose heart's barely able to make it, whose people, doctors say she can't make it too much longer, even with a pacemaker, she gets a new heart. Amen. Evidently, they put the post up because 6 years later, the doctors have examined her and her heart's perfect, and all they can do is case closed, don't understand. And that's good. And it's all God. It has the only part it has to do with me is that I'm participating with Him. That's it. And what did I do? Here's what I did. I got excited about Him. That's all. I just got raptured in praise and worship. I've had so many people, I love to just talk about this because it's happened so many times. I remember one person that came to me and they were deaf in their, I can't remember if it was right or left ear, but they told me because they had been in a lot of different meetings, they'd even been in some, you know, Holy Ghost, miraculous schools, learn how to do the miraculous school, you know, and all the stuff. They'd been through the gamut, man. They'd been down. Everything that came down the pike, they got on board. They took a ride. They've been prayed for by Benny Hinn. This list went on. I mean, you name them. They were prayed for. They were standing in the meeting. We were caught away in worship, just caught away in the glory, just where you don't even know you're in a room anymore. Ear pops open. Huh? It happened to you. It did. That is awesome. Hallelujah. The second time you're here, you had it. That is awesome. It really all we're doing is we're just enjoying His presence. It's just His presence that does it. And when we give place to His presence, and where we give place to His presence is just in this place of praise and thanksgiving, declaring His word even when things oppose it. You speaking out His word. He said, I need somebody to prophesy over me. You prophesy over yourself. What should I prophesy? What the word of God described. What the word of God declared. What God said in His word. Hallelujah. That is so beautiful. It's so wonderful. I mean, because there's so many times that happens. So many miracles happen that way. It's just like, when you live in it, you just live in it. Then your hellos. I mean, just with your hellos. I mean, I tell you, the Lord surprised me when Ann and I walked up on the platform. We came up behind the Assemblies of God worship choir. It was great. It was amazing. It was great in Nepal. And I never had this happen to me. I didn't, you know, it was just, the Lord comes and surprises us. We live in this realm and He surprises us. And I walked up on the platform the first time ever in that nation. I mean, not the first time in the nation, but first time in that stadium. We walk up on the platform and just said, hello. And literally thousands upon thousands of Hindus were delivered from demon possession. The things that, the stories that were told, people who were schizophrenic, that everybody knew, wild men, manic, depressed, violent people that everyone was afraid of, the man of the tombs. Because right across the street was where they'd been sacrificing human beings to the god Shiva for 3,000 years. And of course, they're dead, but they're still a sacrifice of a human being. That's what they did. They bring their body, they burn it to Shiva, and then they take ashes and they put it in the holy river right across the street. And so there's all kinds of demon power on that. And we just said hello, and it was literally the word pandemonium. It's like, it really was that. I mean, devils, the box was open, and the devils were going, hallelujah, praise God. You know, you can look at this day. You can look at this day. It's on YouTube. You've got the primary leaders of that nation are on YouTube saying, you can go on YouTube and hear the primary leaders, the biggest churches, major leaders of that nation will tell you a great awakening came to our nation. We'd never seen so many Hindus come to Jesus in one day, and this has been 3 days, and it's been tens of thousands. And it just, and why? Somebody said, how does that happen? Somebody said, where do you get that? Just getting ecstatic over praise and worship and your passions and your emotions, just loving Him. Just loving Him. You know, it doesn't matter what your ministry looks like. It doesn't matter if you had three people in your church or, you know, and sometimes smaller churches are going to be more accommodating to the Holy Ghost anyways. Bigger churches got to do whatever it is that they think they got to do to please the people. It almost has, you know, but God's going to change it. I believe we're going to have great big churches in the United States of America where everybody's caught away in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You got to spend 10, 15 minutes getting people settled down so you can say something. I'm waiting for that day. Oh, God. Since it's been, you know, 30, 45 minutes getting people, you know, to start moving. You know, it's been 10, 15 minutes. Okay, guys, we just got to, okay, everybody go back to your seat. Okay. Another wave comes through and everybody's blasting apart again. I love those meetings. I love those meetings all the time. I like having that meeting in my living room. Hello. Because I believe that that's the transition from religion to relationship. Because the best of religion goes to church to get, after going through all the mess, to get touched by heaven. Huh? To then go and lose their own life. To go back into the stuff. Come on now. There is no glory being seen. There's no glorious church being seen. There's no glorious church with authority over all the spiritual wickedness. See, Father wants us to come to a place where our eyes are open so we can understand, so that we can see. We can understand the greatness of His power, the exceeding greatness of His power that was given to us when He raised Jesus from the dead. What happened when He raised Jesus from the dead and set Him in His own right hand in the heavenly places far above all principality, power, might, and dominion? He poured out the Holy Ghost. Yeah. Upon us. These are the, this now expecting until His enemies be made, until His enemies be made His footstool. Because He brought us into a partnership so that now He sits on the throne in glory, which you can actually see if the Lord would allow us to. And in the book of Revelation, we know that people are going to be able to see. They'll be, just look right up about cloud level and you see His throne. But we can't see right now because of a veil. But nonetheless, He's still right there. Hallelujah. And heaven and earth is filled with His glory. Hallelujah. If our eyes are just open. And Father wants us to be able to see with the spirit of wisdom and revelation. And how do we begin to see? Through the Word. This is what God says. He tells me, He says, Mark, He says, my church, which I've made you a minister in, is the fullness of the one who fills all things. Everything that belongs to heaven and my power is resident there in the local church, not in the universal church, local church. Because without the local church, you don't have a universal church. The local church is the definition, expression of the global church. Everything that belongs to signs and wonders and miracles, I put in my church, the manifestation of the Spirit that's given to every man. There's all those power gifts revealed. He placed in His church first apostles, secondarily prophets and teachers. Huh? Then the working of miracles, gifts of healing, governments, helps, hospitality, all present. But we don't hook up with it because we come in here with our stuff. We come in here dragging our tin cans of life. Empty tin, rusted tin cans, just dragging them behind us. Huh? Like a kid with his old dirty toys that the dog chewed on. Huh? Clankety clank, clank, clankety clank, plop. Bless me if you can, God. I showed up. I hope you're satisfied. No one would think that. You hear me? No one would consciously verbalize that. But we can be, we're not careful. The expression of our life and the way in our attitude can become that. I feel bad, I feel terrible, and the only way it's going to be any different is somehow you invade my life. So, huh? No. You need to stand up in what God's given you. Step out and begin to move in the faith that He's declared. Begin to enjoy and thank Him for the fact that He lives on the inside of you, that He's with you and that He's in you. Huh? Begin to speak the truth. Say, it is impossible without faith to please God. For they that come to Him must believe that He exists and that He's here. Say, He exists.
He exists.
And He's here.
And He's here.
He is.
He is.
And He's here.
And He's here.
Hallelujah. Stand with me, everybody. Ha sabokota ishte todamoshika. Heste pi roshande ike no bochise. Hando rupufitosi talamakasitano. Halebando rosheo. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, clap your hands, all you people. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Woo-hoo!
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Hallelujah! Woo-hoo! Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord Jesus! Thank you, oh Lord Jesus! Thank you, Holy Spirit! Thank you for your great outworking! Thank you for the supply of the Spirit! Thank you for your mighty power! Thank you for your mighty name! Thank you for the working of your glorious church! In Jesus' name,
rise up from the place where you've been living. Take your stand among all the mighty ones of heaven. For there is a great cloud of witnesses. There is a great company of saints who've gone on before, who stand right now saying, this is the place that Jesus purchased for us to live in. This is the realm that the Holy Ghost was given that we might take the ground. Every mind-blinding spirit in the name of Jesus Christ that would try to hide the glorious gospel in full or in part, I break the power of it right now. Satan, you listen to me. You take your filthy hands off the property of God. If there's anything I'm excited about, it's the fact that on Thursday night, the youth group praying and shouting, caught away in the Holy Ghost in such a way that the building's shaking. Huh? If there's anything I'm excited about, it's to see what God's people do when they begin to respond to the anointing. They begin to seek God's face, begin to pour out their heart, say, I know this realm is available. Somebody looked at me the other day and said, oh my goodness, you're still going after 35 years. I said, what are you talking about, man? I'm just getting warmed up. Papa's about ready to let me get in the game over here. Come on, people. When you got a heavenly vision and you know what Father has purposed to do with anyone who's willing to participate, how can you do anything other than with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might, with every hunger and thirst and thing that could be inside of you, do anything less than lay hold on this life? Lay hold on it. 10 miles a day. Lay hold. Lay hold. Lay hold. Lay hold. Somebody says, what must I do? You must begin to rise up and begin to let the glory of heaven flow out of your emotions and passions. Yes, you're going to have to deal with things that have stopped up the well, so to speak. Yes, you're going to have to deal with things that you've allowed the enemy to entrench you and fortify you against that flow of heaven. But I'm going to tell you right now, God will come and give you the ability to run through the troop, to leap over the wall. He'll give you the ability to break through every hindrance, wherever fortified resistance. Ha ha. Where the flow will be easy. Where the flow will be continuous. Where it'll be a baptismal arresting power of God the Holy Ghost. Why? Because you're willing to do what the Master says. He said to them, go tarry in Jerusalem. They obeyed. That's all they had to do. He tells you, begin to seek my face. I want you to pray continually. I want you to offer up prayer and supplication for all men with giving of thanks. Hallelujah. He tells us exactly what to do. He tells us how to come into this place of communion and fellowship with him. He tells us to be happy. My mama used to say when we're on the way to church, she'd look in the back seat, she'd go, you get a smile on your face or the belt's coming across your bottom. You choose. Which one are you going with? Because you're not going to get to church and embarrass me. We're going into the house of God. Get a smile. Is everybody, does that a smile? You look like a clown when your face is smiling and you know what I'm saying? When your mouth is smiling and your eyes are frowning. That's a terrible look. Are you with me? Oh, my mom's us, I tell you. But that's a start. Your eyes might be frowning, but your face, you got, your mouth has got to, has begun. Hallelujah. 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 What Father has for us in the realms of the kingdom need to be displayed and showed off to the world around us, because right now, Satan is displaying to the world around us what a good time it is to do his thing, because the church has never moved in to the exceeding greatness of his glory and power as we are supposed to the excessive display of the riches of heaven, the joy unspeakable, with all the great provision that only Father can give his covenant people that he's promised. He demands, he says to Israel, concerning all the blessings that he pronounced upon them, he said, you've not brought forth the fruit of it, so I'm going to take the kingdom, I'm going to give it to another nation that will bring forth the fruit thereof. And he's talking about this holy nation, the church, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. And a peculiar is the wrong word. It's treasured, highly treasured. A highly treasured people. God's treasure. The jewels that he puts in his crown. Isn't that amazing? I'm a shining jewel in the crown of the Father. I'm the one that he rejoices over with singing. I'm the one that he is excited in the dance about. Me and my beloved. Oh, how I love his presence. And oh, how he loves our presence. Can you imagine that Father goes about seeking someone who will worship him like this? Because it's the act of engaging in an intimate love relationship that lasts forever. Hear me now, I want to say it again. It is an act of engaging in a love relationship with him that lasts forever. God never meant for there ever be broken relationship. He never meant for it. He never meant for death, the parting of two people who love each other as intimately as husband and wife. Never meant it. Now he's giving us this place to participate with what he does out of the realms of truth, the spirit and truth. And worship is an interaction of love, enjoying him and being with him as he enjoys us. It's an amazing realm. I pray that you'll allow God, the Holy Ghost, to show you. It redefines for you what you believed about praise and worship and prayer, because praise and worship is just supposed to be prayer set to music. It's all. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you so much that you've given to your people in this place the spirit of wisdom and revelation, that they might be able to rise up from where they've been living and the way they've been acting and the way they've been walking to now walk upon your high places and be fed with the heritage of Jacob. Hallelujah. Father said this, if you'll stop doing your own pleasure and you'll call my things holy and you'll do my pleasure, then you'll define that you'll delight, you'll find the delight of the Lord. Hallelujah. There you'll begin to delight yourself in the Lord. Hallelujah. And he said, I will cause you to ride upon your high places and I will feed you with the heritage of Jacob. I'm telling you right now, when that kind of blessing of God is upon your life, men will heap into your bosom. I'm telling you right now, the riches of heaven in every dimension will be yours. The struggle will come to an end. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Today, just consecrate yourself to the Lord. Just rededicate yourself to the Lord. Just make commitments to the Father and just say, Father, from this day forward, I'm going to seek you. I want to learn what it means to enjoy your presence. I'm not going to hold anything back from you. I want to learn to let the rivers flow through me and my emotions and my passions. I want to understand how to do that. I want to learn how to dance more. I'm just going to give myself to dancing. You should see Ann and I when we get up in the morning and start dancing. It's so funny. It's funny. I love watching her, and I just get so happy. She's watching. She's just, huh? Yeah, come on, man. How do you start your day? Let's let God define our day. The day that God has given us every single day is so sacred to Him. It's so holy to Him. Would you make it sacred and holy too? Would it be about you knowing Him and walking in heaven? Will you start living the life that you want to die and go to? I said, would you start living the life that you would like to die and go to? Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. 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 I never know how to quit. I never know how to stop. Hallelujah. You know, I think what we ought to do is just run around the block praising God all day, you know, shouting, Hambra Satananea. Just lifting up our voice and making known these wonderful things of God. Go looking for somebody who's sick and diseased and see them get touched by the power of Jesus' name. The more you spend time in the presence, the easier these things flow to you. The more thought, listen, the world will not be changed by all the things that we've been doing. But I'm going to tell you what they will be changed by. His manifest presence. And Father has purposed that His manifest presence only be seen in you and me. That's the way He did it. You should be endued with power from on high. You shall receive the promise of the Father. Peter saying, having received, Jesus being exalted, having received the promise of the Father has poured forth that which you both see and hear. That's Pentecost. Changes the life of the world. Oh yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Spend time enjoying His presence. Even when you don't think anything's happening, major things happening. When you read the Bible, it's spirit and life. Even though you don't know or realize or think or can't quantitate or measure that things are happening, things are radically happening. Stay there. Don't go away. Be persistent. Be diligent. What's going to happen is there's going to be an explosion of the power of God through you. It will be on a level like rivers of His very own life is being revealed through you. I beg you. I petition you. I beseech you, live this life. Engage in this life like you've never engaged before. Understand this is the faith. This is the realm that if we'll begin to live it, I'm telling you, the world about us, it will be changed. It will be changed. We will see a great harvest come in. We will see it. We will see the millennials come by the hundreds of thousands. Rushing into the kingdom. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 We will see it, dear people. About 30 years ago, the Lord gave me a vision of what was, it's now Qualcomm Stadium, it was Jack Murphy Stadium then. Of the Jack Murphy Stadium filled with people shouting so loud under the anointing of the Holy Ghost that it could be heard from San Onofre to Otay Mesa, from the Pacific Ocean to the Warner Hot Springs, the whole of the county. I saw tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people rushing into the kingdom and there is a sovereign outpouring of God that comes because there's somebody somewhere, in the night hour, pressing through. Somebody, when it doesn't seem like anything else is going on, doing exactly what the Father says to do. It's going to happen. This might have been 30 years ago and I thought it was going to happen the next year. Father doesn't have to work on our time clock. I pray that you'd be right in the big middle of what God's about to do. And you know what? For me, I don't need anything but Him. I don't need to preach. I don't need to go anywhere. I don't need to do anything. I just love His glory. I just gonna be with Him. You'll find me in the church place. You'll find me in the meeting place. You'll find me in the place of rejoicing and of giving thanks. Because that's all he's all I want. And Father says to you, he says, here's what he says to you and to me. He says, ask me, I'll do whatever you want. Isn't that amazing? But we're going to have to say, Lord, ask me and I'll do whatever you want. He's going to have to reciprocate. He looks at us and says to us, he says, I am your shield or your suzerain. Let me tell you what suzerain means. It's a benefactor who is the provider, the protector, and the perfecter. He says, I am your suzerain, which we translate shield, but it's literally benefactor in every dimension of life. Once again, provider, protector, and perfecter. And I am your exceeding great reward. Sounds like to me that we don't really need to do, we don't need anything else. That we got everything right there. Now, what happens is if you'll begin to enjoy his presence, you'll step into that. And now all the stuff that you've been doing will change. You must change. I'm going to say this to you. Your expression, your behavior, your demeanor, the power of God that is manifested through your life, the expressions of your life, it needs to start sounding like more like the Holy Ghost rather than you. Father wants to put a great outpouring in your life. All you have to do is be determined today. You know what I'm saying? You know what I say? I say this. I say, compared to what I see in the Word of God, of what Father wants me to be, I've barely even begun. But you know what? It doesn't create within me failure or discouragement, but great hunger and passion. I'm ready to lay hold on God like never before. And I pray in the name of Jesus, you'll have the same attitude. You won't be sitting going, well, I've done this and I've done that and I spent my time and forget about it. I want to see the dead raised to life again on television. You know what? There's a number of people running around, you know, proclaiming that they've raised the dead, and that's fine. I'm not going to say that they haven't. But I'd like to see it. I'd like to see some movie clip of that. You know, if the Lord told me to raise the dead, you know what I would do? I said, turn the camera on. Yeah. Turn it on. Right. Huh? My friend that recently died, that all the cameras came out, and the Lord said, whatever you do, don't stop praying. He was valiant. He prayed for 45 minutes with them defiantly shaking their head no. But then about 45 minutes, everybody began to speak in here. Beautiful. Okay? Cameras were on. Now go show that, because you're going to show the opposite on TV, saying the man of God isn't the man of God. Now say, the man of God is really the man of God. Look at it here. Huh? If I was going to raise it, I'd say, turn those cameras on. The dead's getting ready to come. Hallelujah. To life again. Praise God. Come on, Father wants to do that. I want to see Father wants the limbs to grow out. And more than that, you know what he wants? He wants his Holy Ghost conviction to so overwhelm people that they shake under the power of his love and goodness and cry out in desperation to be delivered from their sins. That's what I want and what God wants more than anything else. And that Holy Ghost conviction has got to start in you and me. Because if we can just sit around and listen to God's word and it don't change us, we're just... you know, moved by human responses. How is the world going to ever partake of what we've not first been a partaker of? Because we're already in. Then what are we going to do? We're going to go out and reach the world to bring them into what we're in? Father's going to preserve the harvest. You hear me? This is what he's going to do. This is what he does. He said, no. I'll bring the harvest forth. I'm going to bring the harvest forth when I got a place to put it. Because otherwise it's a great waste. Not the great miracle, it's a great waste. If the great catch of fish were dumped on the shore, it would have been the great stink. Instead of the great miracle. Somebody's got to be willing to process it. Somebody's got to be willing to take hold of it like Father has ordained. We're going to do this. Yep. We're going to do this all from here, all the way up to Seattle. I was just with Debbie Rester, right? Some of you remember her as Debbie Ridge. I told Debbie, I said, listen, we're going to partner with you. I'm going to partner with you. You start, because Father's going to do something great up in Seattle, up in that area. So I'm going to partner with you. And we're going to see the Western United States. We're going to see the Pacific Rim. Western United States. Many years ago, a number of different people, especially this particular instance I was in, I was with Rodney Howard Brown. Rodney said, you start on the West Coast, I'll start on the East Coast, we'll meet in the middle. And, you know, I heard that before. I've heard that similar things to that. And we think, well, it's going to happen at this point in time, that point in time. We get discouraged, or we try to even make things happen. All we got to do is see God. He's powerful, sovereign. All we got to do is just stand ministering to Him. Something's going to happen. Big going to happen. That you don't want to be left out of. Hallelujah. Right up the coast. I see it happening right up the coast. It's going to. I've been prophesying it for a long, long time. You know what? I'm not going to quit prophesying because I know that's what Father's going to do. Somebody said, oh, we got to hear this again. Well, you'll hear it more times. You're going to hear it, and then you're going to hear about it after it happens. We're going to talk about it for the ages to come. Hallelujah. We still talk about what happened 2,000 years ago. We still haven't talked about what happened at Pentecost. What happened at Calvary? Halakasapa. What happened at the shores of Galilee? As we remember, it happens again. Hallelujah. Well, dear people, go after God. Will you go after God, Elizabeth? With a greater passion than ever before. As you do passionately, you get so desperate about Him revealing Himself to you. It'll come with such a cry. You find yourself different. You awaken with this likeness. It's like, this is how effortless it is. You go to sleep and you wake up with this likeness. Jesus. Any sickness in this place right now, any kind of virus, any kind of flu, any kind of infection in your body, in the name of Jesus Christ right now, I command that spirit of affliction. I command that spirit of sickness. It goes now. It must obey me. Hallelujah. Burasana. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hatoko namashe. Nauseousness, I take power over you now in the name of Jesus. And I break your hold and influence. How many of you go to the gym? Could you raise your hand? You go to the gym, you've got some kind of workout program. Would you raise your hand? Bodily exercise profits a little. I want you to go to the heavenly gym now. I want everybody in this place to go to the heavenly gym. Gym of the Spirit. There's gyms in the gym of the Spirit. Amen. Father, I just thank you for the ability and the grace to do it. I'd like to wrestle with you. I'd like to jump out on top of you and put you in a headlock until you say, I promise I will do this. I promise I will lay hold on God. But we can't do that. It's going too far. Father can do that. He did that to Jacob. But it wasn't long and Jacob did a reverse Nelson on the father. Is happening. Jesus' name is happening in your life. It's happening. Actually, I've been in the altar call for 10 minutes here. Just in case you didn't know. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just everybody, one more time, would you just lift your hands towards heaven? Is John Crosser here? John, come here. Come here, John. Come over here. Come here. You know, it's a beautiful thing how John came to this church. It was like an angelic visitation. Wasn't it? He was like just standing around. He was like, you're like in some kind of a
program.
You're in a rehab program.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you guys were having to work or do something on the side of the road.
Yeah.
And somebody walked up and said, you were talking about wanting to get back in church or something.
I just said I needed to go to a church that was on fire for the Lord when I got home.
And somebody came walking up and said...
He said, you should try the Abiding Place. They believe in the gifts of the Spirit. I didn't even know what that was. And I looked down and I was thinking about it. And I looked up and you never saw him again.
And it's pretty radical, ain't it? You don't know what will happen. You know what? If you won't go, God sent an angel in your place. Kind of thing. And then, you know, Father just searched out. And then what happened? Your mom was like... walking the dog or something?
Yeah.
You had no idea what the Abiding Place was, right?
No idea. About a month or 8 months after that happened, the guy told me about it. I came to the place where I wanted to go, and I couldn't remember the name. And I was like, what's the name of that place? And my mom saw it, the church over on Willow Creek. And so she told me the name, and I looked it up on the internet. And the most thing that got me was you guys met an hour early for prayer. I knew I was belonged here. It was amazing.
It's like you saw the power of the Holy Ghost when you were young, a child,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. I didn't think there was people like that anymore.
So he was around some Pentecostal people when he was a little guy, but he never saw it in any churches that he'd gone to. And that's just beautiful. I mean, God places the hunger. God's got hunger in so many thousands of people right now that are not just you've just reached. And now, you know what's beautiful to me is what's happening with Lucas and Jordan, the two children. Jordan's so full of the Holy Ghost. She's a 12-year-old so full of the Holy Ghost. Luke's only 8, but he's coming on, man. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. There are thousands and tens of thousands of people like John here in San Diego. Only display of his presence is going to reach them, not anything else. Not our religious ideas, not our efforts, but the manifest presence of God being revealed to our lives. It really doesn't take much to let Jesus be revealed in you. Just fall in love with the fact that you have God's life. You've been given the life of God. The life of Jesus. Hallelujah. I love you so much, John. John is an amazing businessman. He's got he had a business over in a place across town. I think it was like $65,000 a month, and what he was doing, and just felt, look, the Lord wants to change it, and now it's over in another place in part of town, and because he wants to just be used in the realms of finances in the kingdom, and it's just beautiful. I love that. Just take your life, whatever you have, just give it to the Lord. Watch what God's going to do, some amazing things with you. Beyond what you would calculate or predict, do not chart your own course. That ain't going to be the one. Let Father chart the course for you by being led by the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Josh, come here.
Thank you,
Lord
Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Come here, come here. Just real quickly tell everybody what happened to you the other night.
Okay. Well, Pastor Ruth in youth was telling us to get a story every week of someone that we had ministered to or encountered. And so I talked to Jeremiah about going to the colleges and doing that. And we went to college, and it was a 0 out of 10 for me. It was so bad. I had no anointing. I had just zero. Nothing there. And so I was so hungry after that night. And the Wednesday night meeting, Pastor Mark talked about praying for an hour and going after it and taking up the mantle. And so the next morning, I started praying, and I had prayed for an hour. And I felt happy, but I was like, man, this is the same. This isn't different. You know, I haven't gone deeper. So in that moment, I started asking God. I told him why I was hungry. I'm like, hungry for you, Lord, to walk in the anointing. I'm hungry so that people's lives are changed when I speak to them, that these rivers of the Holy Ghost are flowing out of me. I just kept going down the list of why I was hungry. And then there was this point where I was like, oh my gosh, what is this? I never felt that outside of church before. So I just started dancing, and I was so pumped because I wake up and dance, but this was different. It was just, it was awesome. And so I had to call Pastor Mark. I was like, I just had the Holy Ghost meeting inside of my room. It was awesome. And I just want more of the sweet presence of God. And it was so good. I was so blessed by that. And so I'm just excited to keep going.
And you know, and I really wanted to just highlight these two things here this morning for one reason. Walking with God is not a labor, and it's not supposed to be. It's supposed to be a joy. Jesus says, come unto me, all ye that weary and are heavy laden. And I'll give you rest. We make it too much work. We make it too much human effort. Instead of a joy and a rejoicing and a praise. And I'm telling you right now, we're going to have to find this wonderful place of relationship if things are going to change in our impact in the world around us as the church, as the glorious church. And so I'm just so blessed to see these things that the Lord has placed in our heart to tell you and to see you raised up and taking hold in your life. Because if you'll do these things, not only the nations of the earth, but this nation. And the Lord demands it. He says, I want it to be in your home place first. That's the Jerusalem, your home. Your home, the place where you relax and sleep, and the home where you work, and the home of your neighborhood. Amen. That's the other sweet presence of the Lord. If I didn't know that the Lord would leave out of this place with me as he is right now, I'd stay here all day and move. Because it's just too good. But because I know that he'll go with me. Hallelujah. We're going to go ahead and dismiss. And come back later. But what I want you to do is this. I want you to participate with the Lord in the worship. And it can't be a hard struggle thing. It can't be a hard thing. Once again, worship is first defined in bringing the offering. But it's the offering of our life and interaction with him and enjoying his presence. It was an offering of enjoying his presence. It was an offering that allowed access from Abel all the way through. And I could talk about all the expressions of the offering, but it was an offering that allowed access. An offering that afforded the offerer the privilege of enjoying the presence. And of course, we have that through Christ Jesus, through the Holy Ghost. But that offering we still bring as a participation with the Lord, because he's promised to multiply it. So it's an act of obedience that results in the great miracles. Listen to me. Say this. Say the smallest. Act of obedience.
Results.
In the greatest.
Miracles.
Beginning with your salvation. You called on the name of the Lord, look what happened to you. Amen. So come worship the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings, and find a bunch of people around you and hug them. and bless them and tell them that you love them in Jesus' name. Don't forget that part. And if there's anybody who needs prayer for anything, you're sick in your body, in touching your spirit, whatever it is that you need, I just want you to know the Lord's here to meet the need. Anybody dealing with any kind of migraine headaches, anybody dealing with any kind of pain in your body, pain in your spirit, you come. We're going to pray for you. Good. Just come. Just come because we're going to pray. Amen. It's good to see you again. How are you doing? Yes, I do remember you. Bless you, dear. What do you need?
Bob, it's my fibromyalgia and I get headaches.
Okay. But the Lord's going to heal you right now. Do you have a headache now?
Yeah.
The headache goes right here. Well, the headache goes from you, Jesus' name. Look, just look at me. Just look on us. You know, Peter said, silver and gold have we none, but such as we have, give it to you. And so he said, look on us, because the guy who was there begging alms, because that's the only way he knew to get his needs met, was through the money. So he just said, look on us. That's why I say to all people, look on me. Look at me. So in the name of Jesus Christ, the sickness and disease goes out of your body. The fibromyalgia goes out of your body. So when the Lord heals you, and the Lord healing you, you got to then do something with that healing. You want to serve Him.
Yes.
You know, and sometimes that's why we like to see people come stay in the services for a while. I prayed for this woman one time, not too long ago, and she had been in chronic pain for 29 years. And the Lord immediately, instantly, totally healed her. And she was jumping all around, so excited. I would be too. But I never saw her again. I never saw her. I thought, if I had been in chronic pain for 29 years, and I immediately and totally got healed, I would have come back. I would come back. I was like, this is the church I want to go to. And then I thought, well, my goodness, you know what? Maybe we should have done, Lord, is you should have just kind of healed her slowly. Take away 10% this trip, just take 10% the next. God's just so good. He was willing to heal all 10 of the lepers, even though only one came back. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands towards heaven, let Jesus touch you. Just lift your hands up there towards heaven. That's half mass. No one's dead. There we go. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just receive right now in Jesus' name. Be healed. Be healed in your spirit. Be healed in your body right now in Jesus' name. All the soul tormenting pain goes out of you. Just let the joy of the Holy Ghost begin to bubble up out of your belly. Try that. Oh, say, He's filled my mouth with laughter. Ha ha. Try that this. Try that. Stay there. Just keep doing that. The other night I was praying for somebody, and when I was praying for them, I was praying in the Holy Ghost, and they kept trying to repeat what I was saying in the Holy Ghost. I really didn't know what was going on. Guy standing there trying to repeat what I was saying in the Holy Ghost. And he finally said to me, he said, I don't repeat. I said, what on earth are you talking about? He said, well, you're telling me to repeat what you're saying. Is that true? I said nothing about repeat. I said, obviously God's telling you to repeat, ain't he? Well, I don't repeat. Well, you've been doing it. He just got all stubborn on us here. You know what I'm saying? And acting like I was telling him. See, God, the Holy Ghost talking to me. I was on a mochiata diet, and he was hearing it in English. And he was hearing me in English say, repeat after me. And then he would pick up a couple of phrases. Is that radical or what? Hey, what's going on over here? Just stand here and just stand and hug each other right now. Hug everybody later. How are you doing? Headache's gone. Isn't that awesome?
Yeah,
isn't that great?
Yeah, thank you.
And you know what that is a witness of? I like the joy. That was good. That was actually heavy from Holy Ghost. That was actually. I love Holy Ghost happy. Hallelujah.
I'm dancing now.
Come on, that's it. Yeah. Hallelujah. Because that's a witness that the fibromyalgia is gone too.
Yeah, I'm serious.
I know. Yeah. Oh, I know. You don't have to convince me. You're speaking to the choir.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Isn't God good? Isn't God good? No, I'm telling you. No, listen to me. I'm always so amazed at how good He is. I mean, I see such incredible miracle power from heaven, such authority from heaven taking place within our lives in ever-increasing measure. It's just so exciting to me. It is so exciting to me because the things that God does never becomes familiar or old. It's always like it's always such a surprise. It's just, wow. God, you're amazing. So just live in the God, you're amazing all the time. Lord, yes. You're amazing.
It's truly amazing.
He's amazing.
He is amazing.
What do you want? How are you?
Pain.
You got pain.
My right foot.
Oh, Lord Jesus.
That resulted from a bad surgery. A body surgery. And then I have tingling on my arm.
Bad surgery on your foot, tingling on your arm. Which foot is it?
It's my right foot.
So?
I had surgery on my for a bunion. And it kind of messed up my second toe.
Okay, well, just lift your hands towards heaven.
Thank you, Jesus.
You are your hand. And tingling in your hand.
Yes.
Now, Father, I just thank you for a touch from the crown of your head, soles of your feet. Command this old shoulder to come in line in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Out of your belly flows. Rivers of the Holy Ghost.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Pain, you afflict this body no more. You afflict this body no more. Jesus, we thank you for such an authority. Yeah, it's best if you stand right behind them. It works a lot better. I'm gonna have catching school. You just keep running. That's so kind of mine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're just so good as just, I stepped on somebody the other night and they got power of God touched them. I was concerned they were hurt because I stepped on them. Father, this is so good. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I remember praying for a person one time, and I don't know why they came up into the prayer line. Because they had such a bad attitude towards me. But evidently they had something that they needed. And I reached out to touch them, and they started jerking so hard that they hurt themselves bad. Not a good thing. Nah. I never touched them. I just got near them. They're just that rebellious thing, stubborn thing. God's good. Straighten us out one way or the other. He's good. He loves us. No matter how obstinate we are, no matter how much stuff we've done, He still loves us. He still pleads with us. He still blesses us. He's so good. He's so good. And you know what I hate? As much as I hate sin and iniquity and the devil, I hate afflicting, tormenting disease. I hate it. I mean, I hate it to the point that I want to, in every way I hate it. I hate it to the point of killing. You know what I'm saying? I hate it with a perfect hatred. I hate it with the hatred, the kind of hatred Father has for evil. So we're going to destroy it. And you know what the Lord's going to show you how to do? He's going to show you how to not let the enemy of your soul and the enemy of God, the enemy of the anointing, stop you or in any way hinder you from a great demonstration of the power of the Holy Ghost. Lift your hands towards heaven. You know what I think the worst part of sin is? It holds men back from stepping into a greater display of the power and glory of God. It's the worst part of sin. It's the worst part of it. It already mars the image just by the act of it. But then, you know, God's people, praise God for the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses us from all sin, but it holds people back to where they never grow and mature. How they're always just doing the first works over. In the name of Jesus, Bastate, you're doing good. But God wants you, the Father wants you to do better. He wants you to do better. And now, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, Rezojeba, Rezojeba, Rezojeba. When the Lord speaks to you and tells you something, you don't need to go ask people's opinion about it. It is a terrible thing. If God speaks to you and shows you something, what you want to do is just get on your face before the Lord and say, thank you, Father, for showing me you're so good. Now I yield myself to do it your way. Amen. 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 Now, just receive more. I'm going to name you something different. Okay, I'm going to give you a new name. You ready? You are now receive more. Receive more. Receive more. Hey, receive more. How are you? Receive more. Receive more. Receive more. Receive more. Receive more. No, you can't drink while you're talking. Can you drink? Can you drink while you're talking? That's right. Receive more. Kamasateya. Bestakana. Bestakana mea. Rasitala mokahaya. Receive Pantea. Receive Badastoni. Receive Marini. Receive Mondaya. Receive more. Maneka Sitahana. Livananisht. Receive more. Mondaleya. Receive more. Receive. Amondeste. Meridakast. Receive more. Remando Steleno. Balade. Ekeo. Borose. Beriste. Hahane. Marta, come here. Stand up here. Raise your hands towards heaven. Now, watch this. Hey, receive more. Watch this. Just close your eyes. You're too used to looking around. Some people we had to say, look on us. Other people would say, close your eyes. Hallelujah. Right out of your belly now, in Jesus' name. Right out of your mom, the basate, in the mosareka. Malandeya potosi free. Mangalaya pasai. Just stay rabatananeya. Just stand right there. Don't move. We'll come back and get you some more later. What's up?
I know I'm healed.
Okay. You have pain in your joints on your hands. What's wrong with it? Like arthritis or something?
I don't know what it is. I thought it was just working too much work.
Okay. So what's going to happen?
I'm going to be healed in Jesus' name.
Are you going to be healed right now or later?
Now. Right now.
Thank you.
Well, then you're going to feel that?
Yes.
You feel that?
Yes.
Come here. Look at that. Feel that?
Yeah.
Huh?
Healed.
No pain?
No pain.
No, and it can't come back either.
It's not coming back.
Amen. So what's up? How are you? Jesus. Father, I thank you for bringing Lucky into the kingdom.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus. Satan, take your hands off Lucky. Bless mommy. Savitri.
How are you?
Good, sir. God is good.
Hallelujah. He is good. Amen. It's one of our few English words. God is good. Hallelujah. 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 Ritando, stecando, risande, ikina, ninandi, danamando, didia, tananiya, tatanana. Father, I am so blessed that Savitri is going to heaven.
Amen. Yes, Lord.
I'm so blessed that you delivered her from Hinduism.
Yes, Lord.
And we ask you to touch her right now and that pain goes out of her body. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Jesus saved me.
Yeah, he did. I know.
Big accident.
Hallelujah.
And every time, dream, looking, Jesus save you, Jesus save you. Open eye, I sleep a bed. I sleep a bed every day, looking, God save me, God save me. I sleep, open eye, sleep a bed. Every dream, dream.
Beautiful. Jesus. Heaven's glory now.
Thank you, Lord.
All the riches of heaven. All the riches of heaven. April, how are you doing?
Blessed, thank you.
What's up?
Seth smashed his finger this morning. So we're just up here for pain. The tip pulled off. So.
It did?
It did.
Ouch.
It got sewed back on this morning. So.
So hit the tip of his finger was cut off. Oh.
And then it had to go back on.
Why did it have to go back on?
So it didn't fall off. Like the finger literally came off. The tip of the finger and the nail.
The tip of the finger came off.
Yes.
So they sewed it back on?
Yes. It was sewed back on this morning.
We healed in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Healed in Jesus' name. No pain. Jesus' name. Shekotarama. Protection. 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 Father, I thank you for taking a hold of Seth's life. Filling him up with heaven's glory so that none of the things of this world will lay hold on him, take his interest away from you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And in Jesus' name. In the mighty name of Jesus. Jesus. Just let your hands towards heaven. I'll come back to you in just a minute. What's up?
Well, I've had a big breakthrough since when.
Praise God.
But I do want to let you know, it's because I want to see it come to an end. That it's on and off. It's just this. Now I see what it is. It's like a total attack, like on my thoughts. I'm just trying to pull me out of the church, and I allow, I entertain it, but I see it now.
That's good, because when you decide those kinds of things, then you basically open yourself up only to hear from the Lord. So set your hands towards heaven, Nicole. The Lord wants to show you how to worship like Judah. I expect you and Judah to be screaming over there, hallelujah! In Jesus' name. Fiery fire of the Holy Ghost. Fiery fire of the Holy Ghost. Jesus' name. Udai tiki kadai. In a mandadistivi. In a mandadistivi. In a mandadistitistida. In a mandadist. Lord, we thank you for the working of your mighty power. In a mandadistitist. Jesus. Just close your eyes. Close your eyes. Lift your hands way up towards heaven. Just let the Lord touch you. Stand there and enjoy his presence. Just let him touch you. Just let him touch you. Stay right there. Don't go anywhere. What's up?
I just got pain in my body again.
Got pain in your body? What's up with it? What's wrong?
I broke a tooth yesterday.
Oh, my goodness. Well, where have you been?
Everywhere.
But we've missed you.
Amen.
Well, just lift your hands towards heaven. I'll come back to you. Triage here. What do you want? Out. In Jesus' name.
Whenever I'm reaching out to the lost, whenever they see me or I talk to them, I only want them to see or hear Jesus.
Well, that's good. That's what God wants. So you agree with him. He agrees with you. So lift your hands towards heaven. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for the mantle of heaven. Hallelujah. 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 What do you want? Well, lift that muscle way up there. There's the anointing. I feel the anointing.
Hallelujah.
What is it that you want?
My niece gave birth to a baby, her first son, and he's in ICU, and I'm just believing for a total miracle because he aspirated meconium, and so they think he might have brain damage, but that's not happening in Jesus' name. I saw the Lord lay hands on his head, and all his brain cells just lit up. I'm going to send this.
Because somebody aspirates meconium, they get brain damage? That's just, well, listen, the sister, does she know the Lord Jesus?
No, she doesn't know.
Oh.
So she's in New York. So
she's in New York.
I'm going to send this to her, so I'm praying, believing for total miracle, the baby and her salvation, family, her husband. They're Catholic. But I'm believing they're going to get born.
We just tell her that the pastor said that the baby doesn't have brain damage.
Amen.
And that he said that they need to give their life to Jesus. Just tell her I said it. They need to give their life to Jesus quickly before it's forever too late. And then they need to get in a church where the Holy Ghost is revealed. Huh? And just tell her that I'll be willing to talk with them if she'd like. Hey, Leslie, you know something? The Lord's responding to your prayer. He's responding to your prayer. I was standing there waiting to hear what he had to say about the program. He's doing it for your sake. Now you decide how much of the gospel you're going to withhold from them. That's all I'm saying. How are you doing, Joseph? Oh, that's good. What do you want?
I want to come to the place where I stay in the glory and the fire all day long. And I want to overcome anything that would try to hold me back.
Good. Then you agree with the Lord. So, I mean, you're good. That's what he wants for you. Just receive right now in Jesus' name. Just enjoy his presence. Don't feel obligated. Just enjoy his presence. Just take hold of it. He loves you so much. He loves you so much. Just receive. That's all you got to do. He gives. So just receive. As many as receive, not only gives authority to be sons, hallelujah, as many as believe on his name, see the power and the authority of his name. What is it that you want? Huh? What is it that you want? You mighty woman of God. This is one amazing soul winner right here. This woman is fiery Holy Ghost woman. Amazing. Thank you, Father, for the authority of heaven. What's up over here? Bill, it's good to see you. What do you need? Huh? You have pain in your chest? What kind of pain? Is it in your sternum then? Is that what you're telling me? Your clavicle? You have clavicle pain. What do you think's wrong with your clavicle? Huh? You don't know? Put your hand on where the pain is. Does it hurt real bad? Tell me when it stops hurting. Now, the Lord Jesus is going to heal you, but you got to listen to what I'm going to say after he heals you. You have to obey. That's the deal. Okay? Okay? Your clavicle is healed right now, in Jesus' name. Now, what the Lord wants you to do? This may be come as a shocking surprise, something that you've never heard before, but brace yourself. Okay? The Lord wants you to start becoming thankful and happy. Did you know it takes two people to argue and have a dispute? Did you know that? And Father wants you to quit being one of those people, one of the two. Huh? Are you willing to do that? Will you do that? Look at me. You promise me you'll do that? Is baby heavy? Give him to Dad. Lift your hands towards heaven. Kind of exercise a little bit. See how well your clavicle is doing. Say, thank you, Jesus. Say, thank you, Jesus. Say, thank you, Jesus. Say, I love you, Jesus. Say, I love you, Jesus. Say, I love you, Jesus. Say, I'm so happy about everything you're doing in my life, Lord. You're amazing. Go ahead, say that. Say, I'm so happy. I'm so happy about what you're doing in my life, Lord. Go ahead, say that. Say that. I know it's a stronghold. That's all it is. It's a stronghold. So I want you to say, Lord, I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful about everything you're doing in my life. It's amazing, because otherwise you're going to be just unhappy and fussy and just always having a hard time making it through the situation. It's always going to be one continuous complaint. And it's going to go from clavicle to ankle to, huh? The Lord wants you to rejoice right now. He wants you to begin to thank him. He did not forsake you, abandon you, and leave you. He didn't drop you off somewhere in the woods and drive off and leave you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey, hallelujah. Hakateyada. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say, Lord Jesus, I am so thankful for everything you're doing in my life. This is amazing. All this in heaven too. Come on. Come on. Come on now. That's the way this works. That's the way this works. It's acknowledging what God is doing. It's acknowledging God in all your ways so he can move in and do the things he wants to do. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I feel a breakthrough. I feel a breakthrough for you. Nangeshe kata. Zezust. Thank you, Jesus. Mandasteyo. Mandeya. Mande Rusha. Right now in the name of Jesus. Right now in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you for wisdom and understanding. Father, I thank you for your long suffering and grace.
Thank you.
It works with us to bring us to a place of complete conformity to you. To your will. Hey, little happy man. In Jesus' mighty name. Zupata. Right now, lift your hands towards heaven. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Borostai. In Jesus. Now, receive. 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 Now, receive. Take hold of things in heaven. Take hold of things in heaven. You ought to join in the song. Stand right there. Enjoy the presence of the Lord. Don't feel obligated. Hallelujah. Now, don't get all sad on me. Some of you think you get to touch heaven, you get all sad and unhappy. as though Father's going to feel sorry for us if we act unhappy enough. And we're going, you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, I feel so fine.
Thank you, Lord.
We love you, dear. Father loves you. But he's going to hook up with joy. He's going to hook up with praise and thanksgiving. So right now, in the name of Jesus, right now, look at me. Now look over here at me. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's a powerful expression of the Holy Ghost right there. I'll tell you right now, that will change everything. I promise you. Because that's where praise and thanksgiving comes from, you see.
Yes, thank you.
And that's how faith works.
Yes, God working miracles. God working miracles.
Look over me. Look over here at me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. Hallelujah. You just stay like that. How are you doing? You just stay happy. I want to hear that joy. Just hit the joy. Let the joy and the rejoicing. Let the joy and the rejoicing produce within you a new thing. Jesus. How are you doing, little brother?
I have a test this Thursday, so for the acting place here.
You do?
For a college to Miramar. So, yeah.
What do you want to do?
Well, I want to do dentistry.
You do?
Yeah. So I have to take a pre-class before I go to a four-year degree, and then a dentistry professional degree.
Right.
So, yeah, that's my plan.
Are you going to serve the Lord with that?
Yes.
That's good.
Yes.
That is good. Would you be willing to let the Lord make you a person like Daniel?
Yes.
In the book of Daniel, someone so full of wisdom and understanding, someone who so in love with, you know, think about it. Daniel was so in love with his relationship with the Lord that he'd rather be thrown to the lions than to miss out on one opportunity of prayer. He prayed three times a day. Rather be thrown to the lions. He found the sweetness of his presence. So I command a blessing on you now in Jesus' name. And if dentistry is what you want to do and that's what you're pursuing, then in Jesus' name we speak a blessing on it. Yeah. Every hindrance get out of the way. Every oppressing work of darkness, I bind you now in the name of Jesus. Every torment of the mind. You break your hold right now. I'll break it. There it is. You walk in peace now. No, not tormented in your mind, not afflicted in your mind, not worried, not under fear. Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Lord, take this life and let it be consecrated to you. In Jesus' name, you just talk to the Lord like that now. You say, Lord, take my life and let it be consecrated unto you. I want to know you, Lord. I want your glory to flow through me. Your presence to be manifested to me and through me. You need to try to come to the youth meetings.
Yeah.
Okay? Because they're radical. A bunch of radical Holy Ghosts touching heaven. Hallelujah. I praise God for the youth. I praise God for everybody that hooked up with Ruthie Anna and Elizabeth. And hallelujah. Come on. The fiery anointing of the Holy Ghost. So what's up? Silly thing.
Yeah.
It's a calcium deposit.
Woo! Woo!
We commanded it to dissolve in Jesus' name. And rise up and take a hold of the authority that's been placed within your life. And don't let harassing, tormenting thoughts sway your passions and emotions. But rather, take a hold of this life-giving flow that Father has given to you and placed within your innermost being and allow it to sweep you away. So it'll take you away in heaven. Go ahead and live the life that you want to die and go to. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. What's up?
I just want to press in for faith to heal, to lay hands on others and see them get healed in Jesus' name.
Okay.
Amen.
That's yours.
Amen.
It's what the Lord told you to do.
Amen.
You've been baptized in the Holy Ghost, haven't you?
Yes, I have.
And you're authorized. You're authorized, buddy. Just go do it. Just do it. We love all of you. Pray you come back tonight. Just seek the Lord. Just enjoy His presence. Amen?
Amen.
Make sure that you don't leave without finding a bunch of people and hugging them and blessing them in Jesus' name. Tekona Mashiachatai. How are you doing? Huh? You look good. You look good. You've been in the youth meetings?
Yeah.
That's good. You're looking good. Hallelujah. Risata kaneya. Hallelujah. Amen. Hanaseo. Hanaseo Bodavaya. Hanaseo Bodavaya. Hallelujah. Girl, I'm telling you right now. The power of God, the Holy Ghost that's on you. The call of God that is upon your life. What Father's going to do with you, girl. My, my, my. You won the heavenly lottery, I guarantee you. I promise you. I promise you, dear. I promise you, you will not come the least bit behind in all the gifts. See, Father's going to raise up people who know how to function in His realm of heaven in a mature way, that are not held back by all the stuff, but know how to speak the word of life and move in prophecy and move in the authority of the Spirit. That's you. That's you. Some people only want to go after houses and lands and mansions and friends, fame. Other people want heaven. I'm going with heaven. Claire's going to heaven. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.